Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have one item on today's agenda, and that is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses as part of our inquiry on the Scottish Government's Resource Spending Review Framework. The evidence we gather will inform our response to the Scottish Government's consultation. On our first panel, we will hear from Miriam Kelly, Chief Officer, Local Government Finance from COSLA, who I'm delighted to say is attending in person, and Eileen Rowand, Executive Director, Finance and Corporate Services, Fife Council, CIPFA Directors of Finance, who is attending virtually. So welcome you both to the committee meeting, and thank you for your written submission to the inquiry. And I understand you have no opening statement, so I shall move straight to questions. So the first question is, obviously the question will relate to your written submission, and you have said that you basically talked about the amount of spending, and you've said that, for example, a lot of funding, and you've said especially employability funding, has been notified late in the financial year and limited to spending by 31st of March. So there's clearly frustration within COSLA that you're getting late notification of resources within the financial year. But how much of that do you believe is within the Scottish Government's control, or do you think it's because of Barnett consequentials? What do you think of the reason, or a combination of the two? What's the reason for that?
I think in the specific instance of the employability funding, that funding, as far as I'm aware, was known by Scottish Government at the start of the financial year, so was a late notification. We have since obviously received the flexibility to be able to carry that forward into 22-23, which is very welcomed, to enable that critical investment in employability. But the challenge that this presents, the late notification of funding, be it for this or for other elements, is it's not the most effective use of resources. It presents challenges in our planning and working with our partners in the third and independent sector to effectively design and then deliver services that best sort of meet the needs and the intended outcomes for the funding.
And was an explanation given as to why it was so late in the financial year?
Not to me. I'm not aware of the detail of that.
Okay. Ms Rowand, do you have any understanding as to why that's the case? I mean, have you tried to find out from the Scottish Government why that funding has arrived so late? Obviously, if it's something which is so essential, I would have thought you'd be champing at the bit to obtain these resources.
Yeah, I'm sure we have been. What I would say is perhaps just standing back from that and about the sort of announcement of late funding, I think the Resource Spending Review Framework really gives us an opportunity to look at a level of known funding over a period of time that allows us to plan. So obviously there's been instances in the past where we have received funding late in the day, but I think it's important that we focus on moving forward and how we can have a greater level of certainty. So I think if we can work through the spending review and obviously have that certainty in future year figures, it will allow us to plan for a kind of collective outcomes we want to achieve.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would agree with that. I'm sure everyone else would too. I think certainty is important, but clearly, obviously, the Scottish Government doesn't always have certainty in terms of its own funding, so it's difficult then to pass on that certainty. Do you not agree?
Yes, most definitely. But I think, as Mirren said, there are cases where there has been some certainty about funding, and it's taken some time for us to obviously reach decisions on that use. So I think collectively moving past that and agreeing in advance where spending will occur will certainly help us move forward. I know it's challenging, and I think we all want to try and have that ability to plan and respond when there is a level of uncertainty.
Yes, I mean, I think that's something others might want to focus on a bit more, but just to go on to your overarching priorities. Obviously, you know, you talk about in terms of meeting child poverty targets and addressing climate change and securing a stronger, fairer, greener economy. You say there's little comment on the data and drivers behind these three priorities. What are the data and drivers you feel should have been included?
So there are other data sources. The Scottish Multiple... Yeah. I always say this in the wrong order.
Wrong time myself. It's just these things happen.
The Multiple Deprivation Index would obviously give some good indication, particularly around child poverty, mm-hmm. and key issues around there. There's significant amounts of employability data and economic data that could be that can be used to inform some of these. I think for me, the focus on the spend in health and social care didn't seem to quite link with the three key priorities set out. And obviously, the spend on social care is that's the demand-driven projected spend rather than the investment that might be put in at the front end to prevent that spend being needed. So looking at evidence where of how you can improve health, that those would be sort of key areas of evidence to look at when informing the resource spending review for the longer term.
Okay, that's actually very helpful. And in terms of your submission, you talk about there being no clarity on what a national care service will look like or deliver. So what would you like it to look like and what would you like it to be able to deliver?
We all agree that there should be significant investment in social care to support our communities. How that is done, there are different opportunities there. We have structures in place which could, if the level of investment that's been discussed, could be utilised immediately rather than the potential risk of a structural change creating delay to improving these services.
Ms. Round, did you want to come in there as well?
Yeah, just probably a similar point. I mean, I think we all know the pressures on social care with an ageing population, and we've seen, you know, obviously, increase in spend in that area. But as Mirren outlines, we're obviously dealing with a lot of demand failure, you know, and I suppose trying to shift that focus to health and wellbeing, keeping people well at home longer, investing in housing, supporting children and families, all these kind of core areas. I think there's a danger if we just solely look at national care services as the solution. And it's just obviously taking that wider perspective and obviously appreciating the role that local government and our partners play in that.
Okay, and you've said in your submission that the framework also fails to recognise the impact of structural change on current services and the resource implications of establishing new structures. So what are the resource implications?
That will depend exactly on the detail of what a national care service looks like and what that means. But for example, there would be things potentially like harmonising terms and conditions across a number of workforces, IT infrastructure, the governance structures, potential duplication of support services. There's all of those foundational layers that currently exist that are either at risk of being duplicated or seeing change that increases cost rather than investing in existing structures.
So either of you have any ballpark figure as to how much additional resource would be required to deliver this?
It's really the opportunity cost that comes from structural change, because it is disruptive. You know, setting up a new organisation, the focus on that change actually detracts from a focus on actually making improvements, because there's obviously limited capacity and the resources required to focus on that structural change. So it's not necessarily pounds and shillings, you know, it's more the disruption that it causes. I mean, I think the failure report has put high-level figures on the level of additional resource that's required, but we know from work that we've done in this area there's certainly more work required. And I think we have to understand, we can look at increased cost in an area, but we also then have to understand the impact that will have elsewhere on resources that are left and what that means for core services.
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously if there's additional resource implications, then one would expect that to be funded not from core budgets. But I'm sure you'd agree, though, that you know the government doesn't want to undertake a structural change for the sake of it. So therefore, I'm sure they believe and COSM may not agree, obviously, with all aspects of this, but surely they would agree that the reason they're doing this is to actually be able to improve the service overall in the long run, and they might even be of the view that while there may be short-term disruption, it might be worth it for long-term improvements. Is that not the view that they have, and is that not why that they're going down that road? Why else would they be doing it if they didn't believe it would make improvements in the long run for the people who require these services?
So I'm sure that is the case, and I suppose what we're just highlighting is that in the short to medium term it will be disruptive and there will be a change in focus. And you know, it's quite clear by the framework that's been published that if we look at the level of resources that will be available to the Scottish Government over the medium term, it is going to be very challenging. So if resources are going to be redirected to one area, they will have to come from another area, or efficiencies and redesign will have to happen. So I suppose it's just within that context that we obviously want to ensure that money is spent wisely, as do the Scottish Government, I am sure.
Okay, thank you again. I think others want to probe that a bit further. But one of the things you talk about, and this is a real issue for the committee and has been for a long time, is you talk about, and I quote, a genuine focus on preventative approaches. And I think that is really critical. And you talk about with ever greater levels of funding being directed to the NHS, there are other ways, in fact, in which you could tackle child poverty, for example. You talk about housing, education, employment. But surely one of the difficulties is the politics of that. So, for example, say the government decides, yeah, you're absolutely right, we agree 100% what you do. Next time we get a Barnett consequential, we're going to actually give a quarter of that directly to local government. We're not going to actually, you know, put it all into the NHS. Surely the difficulty then is that the media and indeed opposition politicians would then come down on the Scottish Government like a ton of bricks and basically denounce it for underfunding the NHS exactly at a time when there's huge waiting lists and blah, blah, blah. So surely the issue is that everybody knows, in my view, what has to be done, but sometimes the politics gets in the way, and that, you know, given the hostility of the media, for example, you know, they some maybe think, well, is it actually worth it, in that we cannot necessarily say to the public, these are the changes that are going to be delivered, you know, 5 or 10 years, when people might say, well, if you put money into the NHS now, I might not have to wait so long for my operation or whatever. So how do we actually get square that circle with what we believe might deliver better in the long run? Because you talk about the NHS basically, dealing with the actual fixing the problem rather than actually solving the problem. How do we actually do that at a time when we don't have huge amount of additional resources? I mean, if obviously there was lots of money for both local government and NHS, we could do that. But how do we actually manage that difficult political situation?
I think that's exactly the challenge that we all face. And I think one of the steps to take forward is having that open and honest discourse with the public to kind of increase that understanding about why you might need to invest in different parts of the whole system. It goes back to some of the Christie principles and that whole system approach of preventative spend. And I think it's maybe reigniting that. And I don't dismiss the challenge that is. But I think it's one that needs to happen if we're really committed to actually improving the outcomes that are needed. I think focusing maybe discussion or trying to increase discussion about the wider determinants of health that contribute to that healthy life for all of us within our communities is potentially a way that we could do that. And it's not just local government, obviously, that contribute to that, though we are a key player, but improving housing, improving education, improving transport and infrastructure, and in a way that is a rights-based approach and recognises the structural inequalities, could really lead to significant health improvements as well. But it is long-term. You don't see the benefits immediately, and I do agree that is part of the challenge when it comes to these decisions.
Eileen Round, do you want to come in here as well, I believe?
Yeah, I mean, I agree totally. It's very challenging. It would be different if we had increasing resources, because it would be far easier to switch resources to, you know, areas that would be preventative. And, you know, when I look at my own council, you know, it's a dilemma that I face when we do our medium-term financial planning. You know, similarly to the Scottish Government, we look at the resources we expect to receive. We then look at our pressures that will come through, and it's quite apparent that we can't actually afford to actually fund all those pressures. And then it's obviously back to the drawing board as to how do we direct resources to where we will achieve the greatest outcomes. But I think there's a real challenge to us when we work in the public service, and that you know, we've kind of got a duty and a responsibility to try achieve what's best for the citizens. And I suppose it's kind of taking those informed decisions using evidence in order that we can try and shift the resource so that we don't continue just to spend the bulk of the money on treating people when they're ill, you know, and we try and get further upstream and we're able to invest more in, you know, important things like affordable housing, keeping people active, looking at how communities can support people. So it is very difficult, and I certainly recognise that.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the difficulties is disinvesting from areas which are perhaps not so effective and switching resources. You know, I mean, it really is difficult at a time when resources are not increasing such that so that you do have to make these difficult choices. And just one final question from me, basically, and it's with regard to how priorities link in with the National Reforms Framework. You've said that there needs to be an improved mechanism for assessing how we're reaching the National Performance Framework goals. So I'm just wondering what that mechanism could or should look like.
I'd like to see much clearer links between the budget and the National Performance Framework so that we can see where the spend is going towards these outcomes. I think that would help sort of all of us and assist. I know that there's been calls from for the human rights budgeting approach. I think that could assist in that. Would be a key one.
Okay, Ms. Rowland, do you have anything you want to add to that at all?
Yeah, just to kind of recognise that it's challenging. I mean, I think there's over 80 indicators, and we obviously probably measure what can be measured. But I think I agree with Mirren. The challenge is how do you actually tie you know, the allocation of resource more to the outcomes that you want to try and deliver against. And it certainly isn't easy. But I think if you look at where spend has been allocated in recent years, and if you try and link that to the National Performance Framework, I think it does throw up some questions as to are resources being directed to the correct places, both at a national and a local level, I would say.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues around the table, and the first to ask questions will be Douglas, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. Just really to dig a bit deeper onto the preventative approach that we're just speaking about. I keep banging the drum that, you know, I always feel that the best early intervention and prevention is done at a local government level, and I get what the Convener is saying, that it's often difficult to move budgets, but I guess from my point of view, health spend doesn't always have to be spent with NHS. You know, it could be a health outcome, but it could be spent in local government, for example. And I think that's the same as injustice. But it's how does local government make the case for that? And, you know, is there more data that could be provided that shows more the outcome? And you know, to demonstrate to government, right, spend the money here and we will save that money on health and justice later.
I think that is part of the challenge, is because it's long-term change that you try and address, and it's a lot of those are about the structural inequalities. So tracking the benefits through the system over the lifetime of people is definitely tricky. I think that's something that there may be value in having a look at all of the reporting that is done, because local government reports, you know, puts in lots and lots of reports into Scottish Government, but it's not always. It'll be to different departments in different areas, so it's not necessarily all brought together and able to be analysed in that way. I do know that the National Performance Framework will be reviewed shortly, so that might be an opportunity to have a look at the current existing data, where that data is going, and how can we pull it together better to demonstrate what is achieved and what the most effective use of our limited resources are.
So is that something that you think COSLA could push ahead with and try and look at? Because, you know, the Commissioner's right, everyone that comes in here, you know, so we want more money. And it's, you know, as a government, it'd be great to give everyone more money, but there is a finite pot. And it's really to try and demonstrate that investing in local government will give you that return later on.
Yeah. It's something that we've said we would like to work with the Scottish Government with, and I'm hopeful that we'll be able to take that forward on that kind of wider scale of the current data and how it's used.
And it's, you know, because for me, I think there is a strong case, but it just needs to be made a little bit better, to be honest. And I don't know if that's something that Ms. Rowan wants to add to, or...
Yeah, I was just going to highlight that there has been a study done looking at the reduction in local government spending in England and the adverse impact that has had on life expectancy. I think it was Lancet. Mirren probably knows a little bit more about it than myself. So I suppose it's trying to kind of use national research as well that's been done elsewhere that looks at the impact on, you know, investing in communities, parks, baths, town centres, youth work, children and young people, and the positive impact that this can have, and collectively working together with the Scottish Government so that we have that shared understanding. I, like you, do you know, I would be kind of advocating that when we receive health consequentials, that the presumption isn't just that they would be spent on health. I think it's really important that we look at health and wellbeing, and we do try and look at being able to invest some of that resource into preventative spend.
And do you feel then that there's maybe a possibility to, you know, let's take health spend, for example, almost, and I hate ring fencing because we want to get away from that, but almost to try and demonstrate, right, you know, we can make that investment in health at a local government level, keep it almost separate so you can, you know, identify it, so then the government can almost track that through and see what the savings might be later on.
Yeah, it's difficult, isn't it? Because sometimes it's hard to actually evidence the benefit that has, you know, from one year to another. So as, you know, Mirren said, it's more a kind of longer term approach. And I suppose it's perhaps having some faith in what you believe as well. You know, if we want people to stay healthier at home, they have to be fitter, we have to provide them with opportunities, you know, we have to make sure that there is a communities that can support them to be at home as well. So we won't always be able to have the evidence for that, but we will be able to do some work to demonstrate that, but it will be over a period of time.
Because, you know, back to what the convener said about, you know, paying for somebody's operation, surely the best way is not to have that operation, you know, to invest in leisure facilities, for example, at a local government level, so people are more healthy, and then there is less of an impact on the health service later. And if there's a way of, and I know it's difficult, a way of trying to show that and demonstrate that, then I think it would be easier for the government to actually move some of that spend to a more preventative and a local government level. So anything you could do on that, I think, would be really worthwhile. That's me, Convener.
Thank you. Daniel, to be followed by John.
Thank you. I mean, perhaps unsurprising, I'll be sort of picking up on comments made both by the Convener and Douglas. I mean, I'm most interested in your answers under Section 2. And the Convener sort of asked you a bit about the evidence that you allude to, but a number of comments and submissions have questioned whether or not the three top priorities or the three priorities identified are sufficient. I don't think anyone's questioned that any of them are kind of rightly there, but I think there has been some question as whether or not they fully capture. I mean, in particular, I think the third one, securing a stronger, fairer, greener economy, I think that one bullet point's doing an awful lot of work. I was just wondering what, if you were to add to that list, and obviously you wouldn't want to add, you know, dozens, but, you know, if there were one or two bullet points you were adding to those priorities, what would they be? And likewise, I would be interested to hear what you think an analysis of the drivers might look like to supplement what you have already said about the use of SIMD as a data source?
In terms of adding priorities, that's one I can't answer right now because I can't preempt our formal response, which will be going to leaders for agreement at the end of the month. But I agree that there might be other things that could be covered within that. And as you say, some of them are covering quite a lot of ground as they stand. But that's a question I can't sort of preempt our position on. In terms of the use of the drivers, yeah, I found that there is, I mean, while we're sort of saying that some of the data isn't pulled together very well, surely this is one of the opportunities to do that, because we know that there is a lot of data out there. So that section, you know, just referenced a couple of key data points rather than the whole breadth of information that already exists. So I think there are opportunities within the spending review itself to pull together and do some of that analysis that will hopefully actually help inform everyone on the best use of resources to achieve whatever the priorities sort of are decided on in the end.
Thank you. Eileen, I believe you want to come in.
Yes, I think in our submission we kind of highlighted that, you know, the priorities are aligned to COSLA's priorities. I took the opportunity to look at that for my council as well. And I suppose the area that was obviously coming through, which you probably wouldn't not expect, is the role of local communities. And I suppose it kind of goes back to the points I was making earlier. You know, if we want people to have health and wellbeing improving, it's really important that we have strong communities. So as Mirren said, I'm sure COSLA will be doing a submission at the end of the month, but that's certainly from my perspective where I would suggest there might be something we would want to add, and that along with the importance of the workforce.
Thank you. I mean, looking again, you know, what you've gone on to say in section three, you talk about kind of recognition of long-term pressures on public services. I mean, one of the things for me in a comprehensive spending review, which is essentially what this is it's not just about mapping out how you intend to spend money over multiple years. It's also a point of reflection about how effective your spending has been in the past. And I wonder if what you are saying is that there is insufficient recognition of the role that local government plays, both in terms of making things better across those three priorities, and indeed underfunding of local government making those things worse. Is that a point that you are, you know, wanting to make? And if so, are there any sort of particular things that you'd want to pull out in terms of where the sort of the financial situation local government finds itself makes these things better or worse?
Yeah. Absolutely, I think you summarised that very well. Thank you. I think one of the key pressure areas that's sort of recognised as one of the drivers of public spend within the consultation, the framework itself, is around the workforce and workforce costs. Now, workforce are you know, they're a resource. They deliver all of these policies. They're the ones on the ground making the changes. That it's and Eileen will correct me if I've got this wrong, but it's about 60-70% of local government budget is spent on our workforce. So where we see additional asks and additional policies introduced, even if they're fully funded, if our core budget is not then sustained to enable the inflation and pay uplifts we see, you see that downward pressure on our own workforce, which has an issue for capacity, but also morale and also local economies, because all of the employees, you know, that local government's often the biggest employer in a local authority area. So actually, our staff and our workforce are big drivers of the local economy. So the pressure that we face on our core budget has quite a lot of knock-on implications, and I think maybe that's a key point that isn't always sort of addressed.
Eileen, is there anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I suppose if you look at the funding position for local government over the last, oh, I don't know, 7-8 years, you know, the local government share of the block's gone from 34% down to 28%. But at the same time, you know, we've seen significant increased investment in areas such as education and social care, both going up by more than 20%, which is obviously positive, but is adversely impacting on areas like roads and transportation, culture and leisure, and economic development and planning. And I suppose, linking back to your question, I suppose it's looking at the impact of budget decisions on core service delivery and how sustainable that is. Certainly, I've just recently taken my council through its budget, and you know, I'm questioning the future financial sustainability of the council, just given where we have come from in recent years and the challenges that we'll face going forward. So it is very challenging.
Just finally, just one other aspect of this is that very much in terms of the consultation, and indeed some in terms of the responses, very much about how well money is spent. I wonder if there's another element to this, which is actually sort of the principles by which it is actually the decision making is carried out. I mean, do you think that there needs to be at least some consideration given to the sort of subsidiarity is a bit of an obscure word, but actually making sure that decision making happens as close to the point that actually takes effect as possible, and is that something that COSLA would like to see kind of taken into account in the review?
Yeah, absolutely, and I think it goes to the development of policy as well, not just the decision on spend. So developing the services that are really going to work locally for your communities to achieve the aims. I think that needs to have the principle of subsidiarity as well.
Eileen, any final comments before I hand over?
No, I mean, I think the framework document outlines an approach looking to empower individuals and communities to integrate service provision and prevent negative outcomes. And I suppose, you know, there's a lot in that approach that I would agree to. I suppose it's getting to the detail of the how, which is really the difficult part. And, you know, we've alluded to it already about how you actually are able to shift resources to prevention. And you know, we obviously believe that local government play a major role in that.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks very much, convener. There's a lot of material in here. I've noted down some of the comments from witnesses, but I haven't always noted who they're from, so some of them might be from you and some of them might not be. But one of the comments that some of the witnesses gave us was that the whole review is at too high a level. There's not enough detail in it. And is that something you would agree with? And if so, what else should be in it? How more detailed should it be?
I mean, it is quite high level, but that doesn't mean that we can't engage sort of on it to make points and try and develop areas. I'm aware that obviously this is the first spending review in quite a number of years that has been handled. So there are learning opportunities here on that if we find that it has been too high a level. I guess I don't feel like I can preempt what's going to come out of the spending review itself and the level of detail that document might provide.
Okay. Are you okay with that, Ms. Rowand?
Yes, you know, I think the priorities are high level and understand why that is the case. I suppose sitting behind that is the Scottish Government's National Performance Framework, which is certainly far wider. I think the real challenge will come, we obviously have those priorities, but then you have the challenges that are set out within the framework document. And I think the real challenge will come as to how you kind of square that circle, because it certainly will not be easy. And there'll be things that actually influence the spending review that might not all directly tie back to the priorities. So it's not an easy exercise.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, another theme that came out, certainly from COSLA, but also from other people, was the whole idea of multi-year funding and a bit more certainty over well, let's say 5 years to start with. And that came from COSLA, so local government would have more certainty. It also came from the SCVO, who we're hearing from later, and of course quite a lot of their funding would actually come from local government. So, I mean, can you describe how you think it would make a difference if there was that much more certainty? Because I suppose, I mean, I'm attracted to that model, but it does give a bit of inflexibility. I mean, say Glasgow City Council awards money to a local group or charity for 5 years, then, you know, there's not a lot of room there if they're not performing, you know, halfway through. Can that not be changed? Have you thoughts around that area?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think a key point there is that sort of knock-on effect of single year budgets throughout the whole system, the whole economy. And it does sort of potentially mean that you are not able to develop the most effective solution, especially if you're given money that has to be spent within a particular year. And you're even if you're informed about it at the start of the year, you need to do the consultation with communities, potentially design the services, then tender and commission them. So that can create challenges. In terms of longer-term funding for third sector or independent sector, I think you'd absolutely need to build in sensible performance indicators or the agreed outcomes that you're seeking to achieve, and review points if that's appropriate for that particular service that you're looking at within your community.
Okay. Ms. Rowand, multi-year funding?
Yes, most certainly desired by local government. You know, it's extremely hard to kind of plan over the medium term when you don't know the level of resource that you'll receive in the year two or year three. Now, you know, for example, you know, I'm undertaking an exercise just now trying to do some scenario planning within my own council. And it certainly would be easier if I knew what that year two and year three figure was likely to be, rather than trying to make assumptions based on economic estimates and what I think will be the priorities of the Scottish Government. Now, we've certainly discussed this area in Directors of Finance as well, and I think the certainty that we would have if we had figures for a three-year period, even if the two latter period figures were indicative, would allow us to plan far more effectively. And even if that means resource reduction, as Mirren says, we would take better informed decisions on the options that we'd be exploring at an earlier stage, and it would lead to more effective service delivery.
That actually leads quite well on to another question I was going to ask, so I'll start with you this time, Ms. Rowand. One of the witnesses talked about, you know, we as the Scottish Parliament or the Scottish Government should take the five-year approach, and in order to give more certainty towards the end of the five-year period, we should actually not spend all our money now, but we should save some, we should put some into reserves. And just following on from what you just said, that kind of picture would give more certainty. But I have a feeling that local government and others would not be happy if we held a lot of money back.
Yeah, I think you're probably limited as to the level of resources you could hold back anyway. And I suppose what we're looking for is, you know, council certainly hold reserves because we're able to, but we use that for kind of one-off shocks and to deal with things that we're not planning for. So I think we've got a responsibility to obviously the money that we get from the taxpayer to obviously look at how we can spend that and deliver the services that are required. And an example I would give, you know, with my own council is, you know, I would always receive a bit of criticism if I was trying to cut services and there was no real need to cut services because funding was available. So, you know, I'm obviously put under a bit of pressure to ensure that we effectively use the resource at our disposal. So I wouldn't advocate holding money back just in case. You know, I think we've not got enough money and we have to ensure that we use it as effectively as we can.
Ms. Kelly, are you agreeing with that?
Yeah, I am. And I think that key point that reserves can only be used once. So even if years four and five turn out not to be as optimistic as whatever assumptions are put in place, that can only minimise potentially slower change rather than actually address the long-term fact that there is less funding available, so the sustainability issue comes in.
Okay. And I mean, one of the points that has come up, and it's come up many times, is the whole concept of new policies coming in, and you've mentioned this yourself, Ms Kelly, today already, and then what's already happening. And I mean, given that it looks like we're going to be fairly tight for money in the next few years, I mean, would you go as far as saying we shouldn't have any really or any major new commitments, new policies? We should just maybe focus on what's happening at the moment, try and do it as well as we can, both local government and Scottish Parliament government, and, you know, should we pull back on new initiatives?
I think we absolutely need to take the time to consider what can be achieved and what is currently being done critically before new policies are introduced. There's the opportunity to consider, are there things we're currently doing across national and local government that there are maybe commitments to that we could look at those? Does that free up a resource or opportunity to do something different? And how can we sort of jointly develop that and jointly consider it? But at the moment, the struggle that we sort of see within our budgets is that pressure on core and the impact that has on other services, given how much currently is directed, and there are risks there.
I mean, Ms Rowand, I mean, all political parties make promises at elections, both at council level and at Scottish level, and we want to do new things. But do you think we've got to cut back on the new things?
I think so. I'd rather I was able to say, no, I think you can deliver on new policies all the time. But I think it kind of goes back to what Mirren has outlined, about the affordability and the sustainability over the medium term. I think if you look at the likely level of resource that will come from the UK government to the Scottish government, it is going to be tight in 2023-24 and 2024-25. And with the pressures that we're going to face on inflation, on pay and non-pay, construction inflation rates just now are really fairly scary. I think we've kind of got to deal with these core issues before we get beyond then looking at what we can afford with new policies. And linking back to what Mirren's saying, it's what we can do with our existing resource and direct some of these to policy initiatives. And I think that takes us back into that territory about the engagement between local government and Scottish Government, looking at how we can work together to deliver on our shared ambitions. I think the position that we're going to be dealing with in the next 2 to 3 years is going to be extremely difficult. So it's trying to ensure we take wise decisions.
OK, thanks. And my final point, if I may, I think it was yourself, Ms Rowand, you mentioned that the share that local government gets of the total budget, it has fallen from 34% to 28%. I mean, would you be arguing, and would your colleagues be arguing, that we should choose a figure like, say, 34%, and that should always be fixed as the local government share?
I think that's something that obviously can be looked at through the fiscal framework, and there's obviously going to be ongoing work with Scottish Government and local government looking at that. I suppose what I'm trying to highlight is if you look back, you can see an erosion of local government funding, and that certainly is having an impact on things like roads and culture and leisure and the services that we provide. And certainly I think there's an opportunity for us to look at perhaps a rules-based framework that could tie funding to a level, but I think that's something that would have to be worked through jointly through discussions on the fiscal framework.
Okay, thanks so much. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. When I was first selected to this Parliament in 1999, local government actually had a higher share of spend than the NHS, but of course the ageing population has paid to that to a large extent. And I think the issue about having a set proportion for local government and anything else is that the government can then decide what it considers to be expenditure within that particular remit. So there's always ways of getting around things. So anyway, I realise that is at least one party's policy. But anyway, we shall move on. Ross?
Thanks, Convener. Mayor, I'm interested in if you could just expand a little bit on a couple of the points in COSLA's written submission, and it's partly based on the exchange. I think it was your response to some of the convener's initial question. You were critical of the lack of data and drivers for the key priorities in the RSR, but I mean, I was making the presumption that the data and drivers are the indicators in the National Performance Framework and the data that underpins those. So could you just expand a little bit on whether you're critical of the lack of clarity over whether or not that's indeed the case, or is your criticism that the indicators and the data that underpins it in the NPF at the moment are insufficient for this role?
So there's a lot of challenges with the NPF indicators. Obviously, some of them, the data sources are on several-year lags, which make it difficult to track sort of the progress of outcomes. And I think that is one of the things that they're considering, what can be looked at as part of the review to make sure that we have the most useful data for that. And I think that would be helpful for all of us. I think in reference to sort of the comments about the framework itself, the section on the evidence and the drivers only picked up one or two. So I guess the concern is that also shapes how people respond to consultations, rather than that to be fully engaged in giving a response to this the consultation on the framework, other key drivers maybe weren't sort of set out, or the indication from how Scottish Government were going to be approaching that sort of around those other areas.
Thanks. And again, just slightly further on in your written submission, there's mention that there's some criticism of in relation to the NPF goals. It says it's about improving mechanisms for assessing whether or not we're reaching them. There's a line here, these should be integral to the spending review, not just setting out some high-level numbers which are limited in their usefulness. Could you just clarify which high-level numbers are being referred to there? Again, is that a criticism of the NPF indicators?
I think it was intended to sort of show the lack of join up between sort of multiple strategic positions taken. So the budget and the NPF, as sort of mentioned, and sometimes the interaction with the programme for government and how all of those link together and feed into each other.
Grant, and you mentioned that the framework as a whole doesn't reflect the reality of the last 10-12 years, the pressures that the public sector's faced over that point. Were you looking there in terms of, for a framework that better reflected that, is what COSLA's looking for more about the narrative, the rhetoric around it, acknowledging that, or are there some specific points that you think are missing that would have better reflected that reality? Is this just a case of you don't feel that the government have acknowledged it, or are there specific mechanisms, specific changes you would make to better acknowledge it going forward with the review?
I think that a couple of other sort of respondents fed in, the immediate impact that we face now in terms of the pandemic and the rising inflation, etc., could have been more explicitly acknowledged up front. From our perspective, that compounding kind of pressure on local government and local government services is one of the key things that we feel, and we're not the only part of the public sector that do that. So I think I think that could have been better recognised within, and I hope that will be picked up throughout, due to responses and throughout the discussions that Scottish Government are having sort of on this.
Thanks. And if I could ask Aileen, you mentioned obviously like every other local authority and the Scottish Parliament, you've just gone through your budget setting process. How much of a role does the National Performance Framework play at council officer level in the budget setting process? Are the NPF indicators part of your day-to-day discussion when you're preparing options for councillors?
What I would say is that we try to ensure that the budget doesn't drive policy decisions. So we obviously develop our planning documents within the local authority, but we very much ensure that these align to the National Performance Framework. So within Fife, for example, we have the plan for Fife that looks at our priorities, and I've already said that they closely align to the priorities which are in this document. As part of the budget process, we look at where there's opportunities for savings and where there's opportunities for investment. And obviously there's close dialogue with local members as to what their priorities are. And they are guided by the planning documents that have been agreed. But we do try to ensure that the decisions taken by members do align to our plans, which are influenced by the National Performance Framework, because there's a very close alignment between what local government are trying to deliver and what the Scottish Government are trying to deliver. And if you look at the National Performance Framework, you know, in the different categories, local government play a really important role. So there is close alignment. So hopefully that helps. I don't like budget to drive policy. I like it to be the other way around. But sometimes it does come down to the numbers at the end of the day as well.
Absolutely. Can I just ask one brief follow-up then? Has a councillor ever asked you whether to prepare, whether it's about preparing options for the budget or just questions that are about the drafts at stand? Has a councillor ever directly referenced the National Performance Framework and the indicators in it? Have you ever been asked, how does this contribute towards X indicator? Or is the discussion at local level entirely based on the strategy for Fife that you've just mentioned? I'm trying to. This is not me criticising either councillors or council officers, by the way.
No.
I'm just trying to get an understanding of whether the NPF actually does inform day-to-day discussion.
Yeah, I suppose what does inform day-to-day discussions is that, you know, we obviously look at performance indicators with our members, and we do that not just at the budget point, we do that, you know, throughout the year, and we look at how we're performing. And a lot of the indicators that are actually in the National Performance Framework are indicators that we look at locally. So, you know, we're considering this as part of our business as usual in our performance reporting. In the past, in different budget cycles, we have put performance information right at the forefront of members, so that they, you know, that they understand where we're spending the money, what we're doing with the money, and we do try and make that links. That link, rather. And what I would say, in the last couple of years, it's been a bit different, our budget setting process, because we've been dealing with the pandemic. We've had a high level of one-off money that won't be here forever. So I wouldn't say like the last couple of years have been normal, but I think there's that commitment to always look at performance and what we're doing with the money and what we're achieving when we're taking decisions on the budget. And certainly, I suppose, this year, a couple of areas that have been influences, you know, maybe what we're spending in parks, what we're spending on roads, and, you know, the concerns that are coming back from the public in these areas, where, you know, there are concerns about our performance, and that has led to increased investment in these areas, but just using one-off money, because that's what's been at our disposal this year.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener.
OK, thank you. Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Very quick, and I've just got a couple of questions for yourself, Eileen. It's a discussion we've had a number of times on this committee about the benefits of multi-year versus single-year budgeting, and I think in principle everyone understands that. But how aware are you of the challenges that the Scottish Government has had because of its inability to undertake multi-year budgeting? Are you across that, Eileen?
Yeah, so when I obviously look at my budget, I take a budget report up and I look at the position for the UK government, I look at the position for the Scottish government, and you know, for the last, I don't know how many years, we've done medium term financial planning where I've had to make some assumptions on the level of funding that we'll come to. Audit Scotland are obviously very encouraging for us to do medium term financial planning, even if the level of resource is unknown. So I'm aware, you know, of the position of the Scottish Government. I know that you are in a position now where you do have figures over the medium term, but I realise that that hasn't always been the case, and that obviously has hindered medium term financial planning. But I would advocate, even without the figures, you can always do some kind of planning, as long as the figures in years 2 and 3 are indicative. And I suppose they allow the Scottish Government to actually indicate where the priorities are and where they actually are likely to spend money. So hopefully that helps.
Thanks for that. And I suppose this framework is attempting to do that as we all move beyond what's been a difficult financial time. I suppose one of our other concerns in this committee is, in general, the lack of understanding of how the budget process works for the Scottish Government, and then how that has a resultant impact on everyone else's budgets. I mean, you're clearly across that. You'll understand, for example, that it was literally at the 11th hour, the night before stage three, the kind of final figures came in. But in terms of your colleagues, both in SIPFA and in the Council, how clear is that understanding that the Scottish Government, I think it was the Cabinet Secretary for Finance described that it was trying to land a 747 on a postage stamp, which I think describes it very well. But how clear across the board within SIPFA or within councils is your perception that this understanding is in place? And that perhaps might be a question for you as well, Mirren, afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, I take up two or three budget reports to my council in the year, and you know, I outline the position at a UK government level and what information the Scottish Government have at their disposal. So, you know, we make that very clear, and I suppose I try and get. Obviously, I'm in a process with my own council where I'm asking them to make plans. You know, we start this perhaps back in March, and we're planning for the following February, and we're based on the kind of advice I'm giving to the council on what I think the level of resource is likely to be. And then we obviously flex that once we get the Scottish Government's budget, and then we flex it again when there's kind of late minute decisions. So the councillors are very aware of that kind of changing position. And I suppose there's a reliance on the Section 95 officer to prepare them for that. So hopefully that responds to your question.
Yeah, it does. And I suppose the other thing that, going to your kind of accountancy background, I've asked on a number of different occasions whether this kind of data of, you know, you described opportunity cost earlier, of going through this really curmudgeonly process is collected, because that's often a waste of time when you're doing projections which are promptly zapped. Do you collect data on how much time is spent in the process? Because I suppose that's one area that if I were to illustrate its inefficiencies, I'd be looking to say, well, whatever number of days is being used to do this, and then it's all changed at the 11th hour. Do you collect that data? I mean, in terms of SIPFA or COSLA?
I think that's probably more qualitative data, isn't it? Because I suppose, like, the financial planning that takes place, you know, I'm making assumptions on what I think the level of funding will be for the next 2 to 3 years. And so I'm guiding, you know, my authority through a process that allows them to develop plans. And, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years, we've not been actually that far away from the figures that have actually came out. Where there is difficulty and where there really is an opportunity cost, I would say, is we've not had figures for years 2 and 3. And with the financial challenge that we'll be facing, I think it's really important that we're able to take time and plan for that, because we'll have to redesign services, and that most definitely needs a period of time to actually get into that process. So I think that there's multi-year settlements would allow councils to do that financial planning with a greater degree of certainty. And I know within my own council, you know, I'm looking at scenarios just now, and I'm asking officers to bring forward proposals. They might not be enough, they might be too much. You know, we could be more focused on what we're asking people to do if there was more certainty on the level of resources in years 2 and 3.
I think that's a message that's come through clearly. Just finishing off on yourself, Mirren, then, in terms of COSLA and the submission today, how commonly understood is the budget process that the Scottish Government goes through within COSLA? So, for example, do you understand that there's 11th hour changes and a resultant impact in the sort of financial flow throughs? Is that something you're clear about?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. It can be very hard to track and keep track of. I think the last 2 years in particular have shown a greater variation maybe than others as sort of last minute additional consequentials come through from UK government, you know, with the COVID spend. We've seen that, for instance, this year, the 80 million funding for the local government, local authority economic recovery, that was very much the 11th hour and we sort of sought to put to ensure our governance processes were in place to enable discussions with Scottish Government on that and how it could be best utilised to enable it to get into the local government finance order, which obviously has to be put to Parliament as well.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Liz?
Thank you. Ms Rowland, you said something very interesting when you introduced your comments about opportunity cost when it came to the development of a new social care system. And you mentioned the fact that it's not just the cost of introducing that new system, but of the fact that there may be resources which have to be taken away from elsewhere. Could you just expand on that? Do you mean that in terms of the administration of any potential new system, it would be an additional administrative burden, or do you actually foresee that some of the services that you provide on the ground might have to be changed and removed from social care services?
So I suppose I'm probably basing my comments on experience that I've had when we perhaps moved to a National Police Service and the National Fire Service, and I was probably involved with work on the latter. And I suppose for me there's a huge call on management capacity to focus on actually transitioning to that change and planning for that change. And you know what I would say is there's only so much change capacity within an organisation, and it actually diverts from areas such as service improvement and making other changes. And I suppose it's trying to provide that stability for the workforce also. If management focus is elsewhere and they're not focused on where they potentially need to be.
Thank you. Just in relation to that, I mean, we've had comments in the Parliament rather than in this committee that there are concerns amongst local authorities, not just in Fife, but other local authorities who feel that there is a huge potential cost involved in changing to a national care service. Now, if that was to deliver far better results, then obviously there is a case that can be made for that. What we are being told in this Parliament is that there is concern that that might be very difficult, particularly in difficult financial circumstances. So would you, as the financial director for one of the councils, would you feel that there is sufficient evidence available when it comes to the provision of social care that could prove that this new service on a national basis might be better in the long run?
That's probably quite a difficult question for me, isn't it? So I think obviously there's an aspiration to have a national care service, and I suppose the part of it is the devil in the detail and how that service will actually be delivered and how that fits with local decision making as well. So I can understand you know, about the desire to have a national care service. I suppose from my perspective, you know, I would there is going to be an increased investment, and I think COSLA's position has been that increased investment, if it had been used within existing structures, we perhaps would have got the change quicker without the disruption of moving to a national care service. But obviously that's a political decision.
Indeed. Thank you very much for your very helpful answers. Ms Kelly, could I just ask, on this basis of what has just been said, am I right that it is COSLA's position that some of the potential change to a national social care service could potentially be extremely difficult in terms of the use of the current services that are available?
So I think our position is, as Eileen said, that we think that if there's significant additional investment available, it can be put into the current systems and structures. And it's not that we can't see that there's areas for improvement. It absolutely, we want to see it improved. But part of the challenges that we see in social care is because of the lack, you know, the constrained funding that's been forthcoming for the last 10 years and more, and that pressure is built and built. So there is a risk that while that structural change creates a distraction from what could be investment in services and redesign to actually improve the lives of people right now.
So just to confirm that in the current financial circumstances, it is your preference as the body that oversees local government that you would probably get better options of finance going straight onto the front line just now rather than with any major reorganisation?
Yeah, our view is that we can do things now within our current structures and that it's not that there wouldn't necessarily be a place for a national care service, but exactly what that does and what it's seeking to achieve and deliver, I think that's where we have some differences.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That was absolutely perfect timing to the second, Liz. So thank you very much to our witnesses for your evidence today, which has been very helpful. That's concluded our questions, so I'll now call a break until 10:45. I welcome to the meeting our second panel of witnesses, Paul Bradley, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, David Melhuish, Director, Scottish Property Federation, and Alistair Sim, Director, Universities Scotland. Thank you all for your written submissions to the inquiry. And there are no opening statements, so we will move straight to questions. So I would like to begin with Universities Scotland, I think. I found all the submissions actually really interesting and a great contrast, so I'll be asking you all probably a similar number of questions. But just to ask Mr. Sim, you say in your opener, you're quite direct, basically. You say in the last paragraph on the first page, and I quote, "Put bluntly, other areas of Scottish life that should be prioritised for investment, including higher education, look as if they will have to fight for the leftovers from the highest priority commitments." And that's on the back of you saying that the priorities that the Scottish Government have should really obviously include universities and higher education. So the issue of that, of course, is that every single organisation, and I mean every single organisation that comes to this committee, says the same thing: more resources for our sector. You just have to fill in the name of the sector. And the issue, and the question that I want to say is that, and I know you've made arguments about why it should be the university sector, but where should these resources actually come from, and how much additional resources do you believe the Scottish Government should be placing into your sector?
Well, I think I recognise what you say. I mean, that really underlies our comments here. I mean, with a scarce public resource, everybody's competing to make the best possible case for a share of that. And we recognise that in the consultation on the resource spending review, you know, there are really serious projections for what needs to be spent on things that, you know, I think everybody regards as a good thing in terms of health spending and making sure that we've got decent social care and social security. But that does leave the problem that we describe, that if you're not overtly prioritised within that, what is going to happen to your sector? Now, from our point of view, we will be making a case strongly in our submission to the spending review that the investment in higher education is actually one of the key things you should be doing if you want to create a sustainable and green and an inclusive economy. And actually, it's not simply an investment in the sector per se. It's an investment in growth for society and the economy. It's an investment in actually making sure we've got the people with the skills that will drive the future economy, that we're actually delivering the ideas and innovation that will be clusters of growing business and attracting inward investment, and that we're really sustaining the anchor institutions that sit at the heart of so many of our communities. So we think we've got a strong case. We recognise that politicians have got difficult choices to make, but we think investing in a sector that can really generate inclusive growth and actually generate future tax revenues by growing that pool of talented people and by growing that clusters of economic growth, we really think there's a strong case for investing in that, and we're concerned that the projections in the spending review consultation document make it look to us quite difficult to achieve that. So we sit here with honest concern.
Okay, I mean, I do appreciate that, and I think you've actually made a very strong argument, actually, in your paper. But the two questions I asked initially still haven't been answered, which is how much additional resources and from where should that come? Because you talk about, I mean, we had a discussion in the previous session, as you'll be aware, about preventative spend. But, I mean, a lot of the kind of growth that you're talking about isn't going to come this year or next, but the money's going to have to come out of the budget this year and next. So where should that be? Where should these resources be found from? I mean, local government made a passionate plea prior. I know the SCVO are obviously keen as well to have additional resources. So I just ask from where.
I can't answer that question. I think that really...
That's a $64,000 question. I think the government makes its priorities, but if people are going to come and ask for additional resources, it's surely incumbent that people then say where the resources should come from, taxes or elsewhere in the Scottish budget.
I think that is genuinely the hard decisions that governments have to make. I think we are here representing a sector that believes it's got a strong case for investment because it will create opportunity, because it will create growth, and indeed because it will create tax revenue. But I think it's the politicians and who are going to have to sit down and actually make those tough decisions between a number of good cases. All I would say is I think we have an exceptionally good case. I mean, coming back to your question of quantum, when we put analysis in the autumn, in anticipation that what we would have seen in December might have been a multi-year spending review outcome, we made a multi-year case that said over a period of a spending review, if you're really going to optimise our contribution, we had quantified investments that came to about £240 million over a period, building up over a period of spending review. We also recognised that governments are facing tough constraints and tough choices, and that, while we were setting out that's what we would take to maximise our contribution to the Scottish economy, we recognise we might not get the whole way on that. But I think it was a reasonable quantified assessment of what investment it would take over a spending review period to get us to really make the best contribution we can to Scotland's inclusive growth.
That's actually very helpful, actually, to put a sum on what you would require. I mean, one of the areas in the paper you've mentioned is that capital review projects, suffering a further real terms erosion of support for research and innovation over the coming years. Again, the Scottish Government had a 9.7% real terms reduction in its capital grant allocation. So surely, how can you ask for additional funding in capital when the Scottish Government, the only way it can actually meet its capital requirements at a time of high inflation is to actually borrow additionally almost up to its limit?
I mean, again, this is a matter where government has to make choices within the scarce resource available to it, and we recognise that, but we are making a case that if you're going to make those choices, and government always has a margin of discretion as to how it prioritises its resources, then actually investing in capital in universities gives you a good return. Mostly, last time we got an additional allocation of capital to Scottish universities, over 90% of it was actually spent with Scottish businesses, creating a virtuous cycle of growth in the economy. It also helps us, to do what we think students deserve, to study in facilities that are really actually of the quality that we think they deserve. I mean, the problem we face at the moment is an £850 million maintenance backlog to actually bring a lot of the estate up to satisfactory condition, largely because we're sitting in a lot of 1960s and 1970s buildings that, frankly, are beyond their design life. So, yes, you're absolutely right. Of course, government has to make tough choices, but we think there are good reasons among those tough choices, among that margin of discretion that government always has to make investments in higher education and in meeting students' needs, and indeed in making sure that we've got the facilities and capital resources that help us to bid for competitive funding from outside Scotland for research, and to help us to attract talent and international students to Scotland who won't be coming here if they think that what we've got is not of internationally competitive standard.
And in the resource spending review, do you think the Scottish Government should be planning for additional student numbers, both domestically and from overseas? Would you like to see a kind of a growth programme built into that? And if that's the case, how do you envisage that? 1-2% a year, higher than that? What would the balance be, really? How do you think the Scottish Government should balance the number of Scottish domiciled students with those from elsewhere?
At the moment, we are not specifically arguing for a significant increase in Scottish domiciled students. We've prioritised arguing for students to be funded at the level that we think they deserve. Our core problem on a teaching side has been the erosion of the amount of money we get to teach each student. That's gone down by about 12-13% since 2014-15. In real terms, we think it's now gone down by just over £1,000 if we project into likely allocations for 2022-23. Over £1,000 per student, real terms erosion. So our priority really has been to argue that students and the support they get through pastoral and career services and mental health services and all the rest should be funded at a level that reflects the cost of provision rather than we should be aiming for major growth. But I think there is potential for growth there, because we do have an increasing demographic of young people coming through school, young people with good qualifications and aspirations for higher education. So I think there is room for growth, but that's not been our top priority. You mentioned international students, and you know, obviously every university is really ambitious for growing the number of international students. They're great in terms of their cultural and educational contribution to Scotland. But you know, to be candid, given that teaching of Scottish students is underfunded by the Funding Council's estimate by £157 million a year, and that research makes a loss of over £300 million a year, according to the Funding Council's figures, the international students are plugging that gap. Now, everyone is ambitious for growth, but you know, looking around the world today, no one needs to be reminded that there are huge geopolitical risks in that. And I think there are serious concern that the sector and its future is basically being bet on one thing, because the core funding of teaching and research has been eroded and has placed that reliance onto international income to a degree which is, I think, massively exposed to geopolitical risk.
Okay, thank you for that. That's also very helpful. Mr. Bradley, you know, looking at your own submission, you say in the last paragraph, the first section, you say that you talk about the tough financial environment, and you say that's preventing voluntary organisations from long-term planning, as well as harming financial sustainability and predictability for lenders, and requiring the frequent and resource-intensive process of chasing small funding pots at the expense of focusing capacity on service delivery. And I think we're all very familiar with that. And you go on to say that ultimately this is hampering the Scottish Government's ability to address its core priorities. So how, in terms of this review, do you believe that that situation can be improved?
Well, I think there's hope at SCBO and there's hope in the sector that this review will lead to mainstreaming of multi-year funding across government, and not just multi-year funding in terms of here's a three-year block of funding that's guaranteed, but multi-year funding that includes all the positive terms that voluntary organisations need, things like inflationary uplifts each year, flexible ability to, you know, to direct their funding to where they need to, especially over a longer period of time where things change and need to adapt to needs. An example that was given to me recently was from an organisation that hadn't received an inflationary uplift in 13 years. And it meant that they've got around a 27% real terms cut in the funding they get from local government over that time. Now, we can't expect voluntary organisations to continue to deliver the services that we want them to do on that type of funding. But I think in our submission, asking for more money in terms of there should be inflationary uplifts and there should be a contribution to core operational costs for organisations, particularly because there's been a shift to more kind of project and service funding, and forgetting, you know, all the kind of support that organisations need to just run their organisation, HR, IT, and also voluntary organisations' ability to contribute to the Scottish Government's agenda on things like fair work and decarbonising. They can't do that if they're only given project funding to focus on specific services. But I think our hope is that it isn't just about increasing the level of funding, it's about getting the most out of the funding that is already there. I think that is really important. This is about a whole kind of system change around how funding is allocated to voluntary organisations to ensure that they can make the best impact they can in their communities. I would say that asking organisations to apply for funding, chasing their tails to stay open within a one-year annual cycle is wasting a lot of money. It's wasting a lot of government money, it's wasting a lot of taxpayers' money, because that funding is going to organisations and they're having to then use that capacity in that time rather than focusing on service delivery and supporting people by finding new pots of money to try and make up that jigsaw of funding. So that's what we want to see from the spending review. We want to see, regardless of the priorities that are set out, we want to see a mainstreaming of multi-year funding across government. And importantly, not just in terms of government funding, Scottish Government funding to voluntary organisations, but from local authorities who should hopefully get multi-year settlements local government funding of voluntary organisations, which is crucial. I think it's about £500 million that's given from Scottish Government to voluntary organisations, around £1 billion from local authorities to Scottish voluntary organisations. So that's the importance of getting it right at a local government level too. And I was really pleased to see COSLA in their submission had said that they want to see multi-year funding for the services that they commission. But that has to be, there has to be questions asked. If that doesn't happen at a local level, why has it not happened if multi-year settlements have been provided between Scottish Government and local government?
Yeah, I mean, thank you very much for that. I visited a social enterprise in my own constituency yesterday and they echoed more or less exactly what you're saying. I mean, I recall when I was a member of the Social Justice Committee in this Parliament about 22 years ago, we had an inquiry into the voluntary sector, and one of the things at that time that came out was the problem of initiative-itis, whereby, you know, the funders often look for new initiatives for 1 to 3 years, and then, of course, the third year of that project, they're often very nervous about whether they will survive. The staff are wondering if they're going to have another job. They're looking for other pots of funding, and often good projects are established, and then they can be discontinued. And 2 decades later, it seems to me that the situation hasn't necessarily changed that much, or certainly not as much as it should have done. So is that a specific concern still of SCVO, that there's almost an emphasis on the new rather than what's actually working and delivering on the ground and has proven to be the case?
Yes, I've been carrying interviews out with senior leaders of voluntary organisations recently, and we've also tried to do kind of a bit of a randomised sample to get different views from across Scotland and different sectors. And the issue that keeps coming up is that there's a big focus from independent funders, but from government too, on new projects. And to quote one organisation, they feel they're at the mercy of funders, whoever they are, in terms of their decision making and their priorities at a given time. So if you're running a successful project that's delivering on outcomes, really important outcomes, but a funder, whether it's a public funder or an independent funder, changes their priorities in terms of what they want to fund, then you're left looking for where else to go. And I think there needs to be more support for voluntary organisations to manage that transition between funding. But what's really important is that because funding very rarely covers core costs, those core operational costs, it means that organisations, particularly small organisations without kind of, you know, hefty reserves, are really unable to kind of fill that gap between projects. And that really puts them at risk and of kind of lack of financial sustainability. So yeah, it's absolutely something that we recognise and see. I think even in the multi-year funding element, even though that's what we would love to see mainstreamed across government, even with single-year funding, there is so much more change that could be made to improve that situation. Organisations waiting until March to find out, probably still waiting to find out if they're going to get their funding for next year. That's no help when you're working with auditors and trying to, you know, prove you're good to go on a going concern basis. And some auditors now are even asking voluntary organisations to show 2 years of planning ahead, and they just can't do that, particularly if they're waiting on letters from government to confirm that funding will be allocated. So even with single year funding, there's so much more that could be done to improve the timeline of decision making, improve the timeline of payments. Some organisations we've spoke to recently, funding for the new financial year last year, didn't get their actual funding in the bank until October. That's quite a substantial amount of time that some organisations will be able to manage, but others won't be able to, and really puts them at risk. And even the Children and Young Persons Fund, Children and Families Fund, where that's kept rolling over year on year as decisions are made around what replaces that. Organisations only found out before Christmas that would be renewed again for another year. But it's a challenge for organisations in their planning. And one organisation I spoke to said that unless they got that confirmation from Scottish Government, they only had about 4 or 5 months operating costs, and they would have to close because they relied so much on that core funding from government. So it's about, yes, it would be lovely to have more resourcing. And I think that what we would say is that funding the voluntary sector is a choice of government to deliver on the outcomes in the national performance framework and the type of fairer, stronger, greener economy we want. But if we can't have more funding, let's look at how we change the funding system so we get most out of the funding that's already there.
Yeah, I think that's really, really fundamentally important, because at a time of financial challenge, I'm not convinced that there will be significant additional funding. I mean, let's be realistic about it, but if it can be spent much more effectively and efficiently. And indeed, you know, I can only imagine how difficult it is for staff year in, year out, wondering if they're going to have a job following start financial year and having to wait months and months for these processes. It really is unacceptable and something we need to fundamentally address. Now, David Mellish, you've in your paper in the second section, you talk about saying about resources being directed towards areas of government dedicated to supporting economic development. So, I'll put to you the kind of question I put to Mr. Sim earlier on: how much additional resources do you believe should be put to that, and where should these resources be funded from?
Thank you. I mean, I think our intent in that is to suggest that some of the challenges we need to provide the platform for the new economy, which is one of the priorities of the resource spending framework, looking towards the transition to net zero and so on, are so huge that there is no way that either public sector or private sector can independently try and address them. So we think that you do need to see a significant increase in capital funding, although much of our response in this was directed towards resource spending. So I think the resource spending would be into supporting the various economic and enterprise departments of the Scottish Government to be able to support business to actually help to grow the economy and therefore provide the tax revenues. I think earlier in the discussion was the virtuous circle that was mentioned in that. But, I mean, there is no doubting that if you look at some of the costs now associated with the need to transform our built environment and our economy, you're well into the stretch of tens of billions over a 10-15-year period. So 200 million capitalisation or even 1.8 billion over the period from the Scottish Government is really just tapping into resource. So I think much more has to be done to try and provide a platform for the private sector to come forward with the support that it can to provide that key investment if the objectives of the transition to a net zero economy are going to be achieved.
Yes, I mean, I hear what you're saying, significant increase and much more, but how much more and what does significant mean? Is it 5%, 10%? And given the fact that, as I've already mentioned to Mr. Sim, there's a significant reduction, 9.7% in real terms in the capital allocation that the Scottish Government capital. I mean, you know, where are we going to find these resources from? I mean, if we're going to have look at a financial review that looks at things long term, then we have to really be able to, you know, surely put some numbers on these or percent, you know, whether it's percentages or amounts. I mean, saying significant increase doesn't mean anything to me. I mean, statistically, a significant increase can be what, 1-3%. Other people might think it's 10 or 20%. What do you actually mean, and how should that be funded?
Well, I think it's, I mean, I'd have to echo some of the comments earlier. Obviously, we're not the politicians; we can only paint the problem in a way. We do think that there are strong arguments for some enhanced borrowing powers, and I think that's one that is a debate between the different governments that is going on now. There is, I say, you know, little doubt of the pressures on the government's budgets. We do recognise that, but I think if you're going to break that spiral of decreasing revenue, which we've painted in our submission in terms of the concerns around Scottish income tax, our concerns about the tax base of the non-domestic rate system as well. If you're going to break out of that, I think you have to do it through trying to build growth into the economy. And I think it is for the government to help the private sector by building the platform for that investment that can come forward. So what we would say is, I think, 200 million or thereabouts capitalisation for SNIB is Scottish National Investment Bank. It is we've always said we feel is far too little, and that more needs to be achieved in that. And given that's a bank, and that therefore that's hoping to, you know, leverage additional finance, you know, I think that could be a way of the government potentially maximising its investment.
Okay, I'm not going to be able to pin you down much further, I think, although you have mentioned enhanced borrowing, that's something. In terms of non-domestic rates, I was going to move on to that, but you did touch on that, so I'll just mention that just now. I mean, basically, you mentioned something which, in fact, myself and other members of this committee obviously identified, which was the significant prediction and rise in non-domestic rates income over the next few years, which I raised eyebrows about, and I think a number of colleagues did as well. You say in your statement, this implies an expectation of rateable valuation uplifts for commercial properties, which may not materialise as the economy adapts to the post-COVID era, particularly if there's a reduction in the number of NDR-producing commercial properties as buildings are changed to alternative uses. So how do you see this, the market going? Do you feel that predicted rise in non-domestic rates is achievable? Is it even realistic? Or do you think things are going to stay much the same or possibly deteriorate? What does the SPF feel the position is, and how would that fit in terms of the Scottish Government's framework going forward?
Well, we've made your reservations that the uplifts are going to be achieved. I think we've seen in the pandemic an acceleration of the decline in retail property outlets across the country. There is also, on the other side of it, there's probably going to be an increase, probably in Central Belt Grade A, so top level office rateable values. But I think our point is that we do not think that increase or potential increase is going to accommodate for the decline in the commercial property rateable value tax base across the country as a whole. So that's why we do question the expectations of increases over the next few years.
Yeah, I mean, you do go on actually to say, and I quote, there is a well-documented change in consumer behaviour, and you do talk about, in actual fact, the loss of economic productivity and tax revenue associated with these falls.
And also, I mean, offices may not be in as much demand given the changes in working lifestyles as well that are on. So, you're already seeing, obviously, a transfer potentially of some offices, conversions perhaps to more residential uses. Potentially that will improve council tax base, but, not certain at this stage. So we're really just primarily focusing on the NDR base there.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, Mr Bradley, when the question was asked, does the framework properly reflect the current economic and political context, SCVO responded that, and I quote, there is little recognition of the integral role played by the voluntary sector in social and economic life. From whom is there little recognition? Because, I mean, my understanding is there's a lot of recognition, I mean, at all levels in Scottish society. So I wonder if you can expand your thoughts on that a wee bit.
Yeah, I think it is far better in Scotland, and even just looking at the UK government's Levelling Up report last week or a couple of weeks ago, and referring to the charity sector as delivering 1,000 acts of kindness, I think we're in a much better space in Scotland than referring to the sector in that way. And I think it is recognised we're a crucial part of the Scottish economy. I totally get that, and I think we've seen that in terms of the government's response during the pandemic and the speed in which they worked to deliver emergency funding to the sector, and it highlighted the importance of the sector. I think our experience, though, is that if you look at the development of economic policy in Scotland, it is very difficult to see the place of the voluntary sector in terms of those different kind of products and different initiatives. The National Investment Bank, we've mentioned that already. If we're trying to think about new ways in which sectors are funded and supported, there's no reason why voluntary organisations, who are delivering, some significant services, couldn't access that type of loan, flexible finance. And it's something that SCBO worked very hard to get in the bill, was to ensure that voluntary organisations would be able to access that. But there's been no discussion about what that could look like in the future. So that's one example, if we're trying to think about innovative ways in which we support the sector. But even if the Council for Economic Transformation strategy that's been published as we sit here now, I had a little look through before I came into the meeting, and there's a few mentions of the sector in there, but mainly focusing on kind of public and private sectors, and a lack of any voluntary sector engagement in terms of the top table of trying to set that economic strategy for the next 10 years. So if you don't have voluntary organisations or a representative of some sorts engaging in those kind of discussions, then there's a missed opportunity there in terms of getting the most out of a sector which delivers care, digital inclusion initiatives, is so important for volunteering, mental health services, a whole range of things. If you look at the sector and its contribution to the national outcomes, it covers all of that. So why is it that the voluntary sector is always missing from these discussions about the economic direction of Scotland?
Yeah, I mean, you're probably aware that last Thursday we took evidence from the Secretary of State, Michael Gove, actually, and I did put forward some of the concerns that SCV had raised in the submission directly to him, and, you know, because obviously SCVO and the voluntary third sector is a multi-billion pound, contribution to Scotland, just in cash terms, not to mention its phenomenally important social aspects. Were you reassured by the responses that he actually gave? Because when I obviously put these to him, he kind of indicated that the UK government wanted to do a lot more in terms of support for the sector.
Yes, and thank you for raising that in that session. We'll absolutely contact organisations that are in receipt of EU funding just now and face a cliff edge to ensure they get in touch with their elected representatives. That's what we'll do. And we are engaging with the Department for Levelling Up and colleagues in Scotland, in the Scotland office and so on. But my understanding really is that there's uncertainty within those who work in the civil service. So there's obviously going to be uncertainty for voluntary organisations just now whose funding, you know, is facing a cliff edge. And there's also lots of other changes in terms of funding just now. If you look at things like employability too, and funding into that, change to no one left behind, and move to kind of local service delivery. There's lots of organisations that are facing kind of an end to their funding in different areas, and the EU structural social funds are just one aspect of that. And we are concerned, but we are engaging with government, UK government on that. We're concerned that there is a lack of, we've said this from the very start, and I know that members of the Cabinet have raised this in Parliament around the fact that there is an absence of Scottish Government in terms of the delivery of the UK Shared Prosperity Fund in Scotland. And I think that's what we're concerned about. We don't know who's taking the decisions here in Scotland around what's being funded through UK Shared Prosperity Fund. An example would be in the UK. The UK government have said that for the first 2 years they won't be focusing on funding people and skills. They have kind of oversight of that, and that's what they're saying to local authorities, but they will support some continuation of successful projects where those are at risk. In Scotland, we don't know, because obviously England aren't, the UK government aren't responsible for that, but who is taking the decisions on what's going to be funded in Scotland through the UK Shared Prosperity Fund in the first 2 years and then the following years. So there's a lot of confusion, and very, very pleased that it was raised in the committee last week, because we're concerned that obviously that local government has a big role to play in this, but we're concerned about voluntary organisations getting access to that funding, particularly given the kind of cliff edge that organisations are facing to funding.
Okay, thank you. Now, just one final question, and I'll open with Mr. Sim, so I'll close with Mr. Sim before allowing colleagues in. And it's with regard to the framework properly reflecting current economic and political context. And basically, what you've said is that shouldn't the Scottish Government set a priority of making Scotland more competitive and attracting a working age population from outside our borders and stimulating robust economic growth to create jobs that attract them? Now, putting to one side the issue of obviously external migration, obviously there are a lot of people from elsewhere in the UK that we could attract to Scotland. Why do you feel that the Scottish Government is not doing that?
I don't think it's necessarily the Scottish Government are not doing that. It's just if you read the consultation document on the resource spending review, it kind of sounds like it's making quite static assumptions about our demography and economic growth, whereas I felt that the consultation paper could have communicated a much stronger ambition for economic growth and indeed for demographic growth of our working age population. It seemed to take it as a given that we would be seeing this rebalancing between working age and an increased non-working age population. And so, you know, looking at it from a university perspective, you know, we are one of the huge magnets of talent to Scotland, whether it's from the rest of the UK, whether it's from the EU and further internationally. And I think just a bit of recognition in the spending review that there should be prioritisation given to things that can be done in society and the economy that lever in talent and that create growth. I think that could have had a stronger emphasis. It felt a bit like it was assuming that we were on a particular economic and demographic trend rather than asking hard questions about how can you buck that trend and really hypercharge demographic growth and economic growth.
To be more ambitious in that context. Right. Okay, I've taken up enough time. I'm going to let colleagues in, obviously. So the first person to ask questions will be Liz, to be followed by Daniel.
Thank you. Mr. Simmel, I hope you don't mind if I continue questioning on exactly that theme. In your submission, you were very clear that one of the issues that worries you is the fact that when it comes to things like research and innovation, artificial intelligence, etc., that is now classified on the capital side of spend rather than on the resource side of the spend. And the National Performance Framework obviously really concentrates on the latter. Could you just expand on what you would like to see in terms of what I think all of us in this Parliament would argue is one of the great strengths of the university sector in Scotland, is research and development. And you mentioned earlier in your comment about Scotland being able to attract the absolute finest people to come here. What would you like to see in terms of the recognition for that? Because that's obviously one of the sustaining factors of the sector.
Yes, and you know, obviously we've already seen output from the capital spending review and its outcome that, you know, as a convener noted, projects real terms decline in capital expenditure for universities. So, you know, that is a concern. I mean, a basic structural issue is that the core Scottish Government funding, which, as Ms. Smith says, is now categorised as capital, the core Scottish Government funding for research, it pays for essential research infrastructure, essential research staff. That is a platform that one then uses as a university to go out and bid for competitively won research resources, whether it's from UK research and innovation or industrial sources, or, you know, hopefully in a few, we'll be back into Horizon Europe soon as well. So those leverage in you know, huge amounts of money to Scotland. I think we lever in I think about sort of £800 million a year into Scotland for research, and then that catalyses economic growth. It generates ideas that then turn into innovation and industrial growth and company growth and attraction of inward investment. So you know, our concern is that actually, in an experimental sense, what we have seen is a really substantial real terms erosion of core research funding from Scottish Government since 2014-15. I do have the figures here. I think from the top of my head, it's about a 13% real terms reduction. And that corresponds with an actual reduction in our success in leveraging in these external resources. Back in 2013, we were getting, you know, just nearly 16% of UK investment in research and innovation. The latest figures are that we're down below 13% of that resource, that UK level resource coming to Scotland. So, you know, I just, again, coming to this virtuous cycle of creating growth, and you know, I think there are various economic estimates, you know, but basically I think the estimates range are you get about an eightfold to tenfold multiplier in economic growth from your research investment. You know, we think we're seeing a slow degradation of our capacity to be a real motor of innovation and economic growth.
Could I just ask, Mr. Sim, when it comes to the outcome agreements that are obviously established between an individual university and the Scottish Funding Council, is it true to say that the what you exactly enunciated just now is the main concern of individual universities as they approach their discussions with the Funding Council about their outcomes that are, you know, being determined over the next while? Do they all share that view that that's where some potential problem could really hit hardest?
I think actually there are three things that kind of keep them awake at night when they're looking at the outcome agreement. I mean, one is, as you say, this progressive degradation of our capacity to compete and lever in research resources into Scotland from outside and create growth through that. I think, as I alluded to earlier, they are also seriously worried about the amount of money that is allocated for each student, for teaching and for all the pastoral and careers and mental health support that students need. And, you know, that's already for 2021 to 22 eroded in real terms by about £850 per student since 2014-15. We reckon it'll be over £1,000 in real terms next year. We're getting, I think, on average, about £7,400 per student, compared to England getting £9,250. So it just doesn't pay. What you see then is you know, people, you know, staff having to work harder and harder and harder to meet the needs of students from a diminishing resource, which is a serious concern. And I think the third thing, and again this relates to economic growth, is funding for knowledge exchange. I mean, we work with a lot of businesses. I mean, universities work with about 20,000 businesses a year to provide consultancy and expertise, and about 35,000 people a year do continuing professional development at universities. This is typically done at a loss, not least because Scotland is an SME-based economy, so it's the right thing to do, but it's a loss leader. And again, you know, we're seeing year-on-year erosion of the funding. It goes into having a staff that can really do that detailed engagement with business, you know, where it can be so catalytic for employment and growth and addressing that long tail of uninnovative businesses. There's been such a break on the Scottish economy.
So my final point, Mr. Sim, would be that is there evidence when it comes to the cutting edge of innovation and research where Scottish universities have punched well above their weight for a very long time, is there evidence that the Scottish universities are finding it more difficult to be at the leading edge? In other words, if there are projects where the knowledge exchange that you spoke about and international cooperation, which has absolutely been crucial to many universities in Scotland, over the, particularly in the last two decades, is there evidence that you feel that that is being undermined because of funding?
I think there is still, you know, absolutely brilliant stuff being done across the sector, and, you know, I think in May we'll see that the results of the Research Excellence Framework across the UK, and hopefully it will affirm, you know, still a lot of really top-class international strength in Scottish universities. But I think the objective evidence I would come back to is the reducing competitiveness of actually getting out there and winning resources. These are won on the basis of having high-quality bids, often high-quality collaborative bids, having the really world-class facilities where you can do research, having world-class researchers. I still think we're doing well. I still think there's absolutely fantastic research across the sector, but that metric is a really worrying one that shows that where we used to be, you know, heavyweight and competing above our weight, we're maybe a bit more welterweight now.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Daniel's been followed by John.
I'll probably ask each of you a question, beginning with Alistair Sim, just leading really off where Liz left that. I mean, in your submission, you state that the teaching grant has declined by 13% since 2014-15. I'm just wondering if you could bring to life what actually the practical impacts of that has been, and I think essentially your submission is saying, you know, we can't carry on that slow decline. I mean, if we are sitting here in 5 years' time, and essentially, you know, that trend has straight-lined, what will be the consequences for higher education as a sector, and indeed for individual institutions?
I'll be candid. This can be quite a difficult area for individual institutions to address, because going back to the beginning of this conversation, they're all competitive, trying to attract international students, and that has become so core to the business and to, you know, getting the resources into the sector to actually enable us to do our best for Scottish students. So, but I'll try and generalise, and I think what one already sees across some institutions and would see more of is an erosion of staff to student ratio, that the staff are having to support more students and support more students more intensely, because not only are you having to offer teaching and feedback, and I think our experience is that staff are now having to address, frankly, increased welfare and mental health needs of students. I think that was increasing before the pandemic. It's been accelerated by the pandemic, and also to address the lost learning that students have faced as a result of the pandemic, whether they're coming on from school or college or wherever, or even from their early years of university. The disruption to their learning is meaning they're now needing more intensive input from academics. And also just access to services. I mean, I think already, you hear students saying that if they wanted pastoral support or if they wanted careers advice, they're not always getting it as quickly as they would want to. So the risk you face, I think, over time is just, more stress on staff, less attention to the individual student, and just, I think institutions will do everything they can to avoid it, because, you have to put the student absolutely centre of everything. But if this resource keeps diminishing in real terms, it just gets harder and harder and harder to do your best for the student in terms of teaching, in terms of support, and in terms of the student being in the quality of facility that they deserve.
Can I ask just a very direct follow-up question to that? I mean, obviously, they can't charge fees for tuition, but will this lead to a situation where institutions will charge fees for things that they can charge fees for, like increasing accommodation fees or indeed fees for access to other things on campus which aren't tuition?
I don't know, is the honest answer. I mean, I think, looking at it from a values-based approach, there's been such a strong and right emphasis on making sure that access to university is socially inclusive, and that people aren't denied opportunity because of the circumstances that they come from. I think that would be really hard steps. But I'm also being candid that increasingly there are stresses on the system, and stresses on the system that are affecting students and staff.
Thank you. So moving on to the Scottish Property Federation's submission. I mean, I think, first of all, as a former retailer, I was pleased that you were highlighting the issues faced by that industry. But I think the broader point, as opposed to the specific point being we can't rely upon non-domestic rates, I think there's actually a broader point here, is that the document presented essentially treats the resource funding as fixed and uncontrollable, whereas, I mean, to my mind, there is insufficient examination as to what things it can control, the government can control to increase its revenue, primarily around income tax, which, given that is set to become an increasing problem as set out in the Fiscal Commission forecast. I'm just wondering if the Property Federation have thoughts about what sorts of things need to be included into that, what levers and dynamics are at play within the economy that this review should take into account.
I mean, there's also directly related to that, of course, just last Friday we saw UK government come up with ideas of an online sales tax, which would have impacts on business rates potentially down the line. It might not help to the clarity of the budget setting process, because I think it would be a sort of funding rebate, if you like, from the initial view. But I think in terms of priorities and things which need to be addressed, I mean, we're about wanting to grow the tax base through growing the economy. I mean, that's really what we want to see. We want to see our towns and cities thrive and be able to have that built environment that puts a roof over the economy, supports new places for people to live and learn, supports the higher education sector as well through accommodation needs and other needs that it has. That's going to take some support, in particular through the planning system, and we make this point in our submission too. And that's a sector which has had, I think, budget cuts of around 40% over the last 10 years. So it's, obviously, COSLA were on talking to you earlier, and very understandable pressures that they have on that budget. But, you know, the Parliament in 2019 basically voted through 49 new burdens on planning departments across Scotland, and they have not had the resource allocated to help address that and begin to support the economy, to begin to support the transition to net zero. And I think that planning must have a much higher priority within the resource spending framework to be able to be that platform for investment that hopefully gets us into that virtuous circle. So, I mean, we're hugely concerned about that. And actually, in the scale of funds across Scotland, I mean, I think the RTPI put a figure on about 60 million over, a decade's process of those new burdens. So, you know, this is one where resource has not come forward to support the planners to address those issues. In the context of a multi-billion budget, you know, this would seem an area where, you know, it's not asking for additional volumes of hundreds of million, but it could be so crucial as a catalyst to supporting the economy to rebuild. So I think that's, I know for our sector, that's a deep concern. I think, Convener, you led off by saying most sectors ask for more money, but they don't offer to put more money in. I think this is, for once, a sector where we have said we pay higher planning fees to help contribute towards the economy. Planning fees have just gone up, of course, quite recently. Our members do wish to see an improvement in service as part of that, but which I think is only fair enough. But I think for us, that's probably the most critical lever into the, you know, the day-to-day spending that we see across government, across local government, across the country.
Mm-hmm. I think that link between the planning system and kind of the productivity in the economy is one that is often overlooked. And I should probably just advise the committee that my wife is a planning lawyer after making that comment, which doesn't stop me from railing against the planning system at home. Can I just ask, just briefly, I just did a quick word count of the document, and I was surprised to find that jobs only appears once in the government's document, employment only appears twice, and productivity only appears once. I mean, I just wonder if you'd agree with me that in the document and the review, once it's produced, should probably have those words featured a few more times than that. And it's a slightly flippant question, but I wonder if I can put it to you.
well, yes. I mean, we see that. I mean, all the other ambitions will simply not be achieved unless you have a growth in employment and people paying the tax revenues to support the wider ambitions. So. And would include productivity as part of that. So, yes, we agree.
So, finally, Mr. Bradley, I'll just come to you. And I was listening to your interaction with the convener, and what struck me is actually we continue to talk about the budget and about the voluntary sector as though it's just that, as a sector made up of volunteers doing nice extra things. Do we think we actually need to have a proper discussion and reassessment? Because I don't think that is the nature of most of the organisations, really, what we're talking about. What we're talking about is independent, not-for-profit service delivery providers, because, you know, they are staffed by professionals. The services that you're delivering are delivered by professionals. And indeed, probably, you know, a significant number will be that's all they're doing, is essentially delivering services on behalf of the public sector, or at least, you know, the majority. I mean, is that a fair reflection, and do we need to have a bit of a grown-up conversation about the relationship between, quote-unquote, the voluntary sector and the state?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. The voluntary sector is, you know, made up predominantly of organisations that are led and run by volunteers, but particularly when we're talking about this multi-year funding aspect and delivery of services, it is those organisations that, you know, have the staff teams. And what we've been trying to do at SCBO for a number of years is trying to work more collaboratively with the Scottish Government and with COSLA to try and look at how we can strengthen collaboration, strengthen partnership working. And also, I think, really importantly, that's come through all the conversations that I've had with organisations from across all the different subsectors, whether it's about poverty or environment or health and social care, is the need for there to be greater recognition in the public sector of the added value and the contribution that voluntary organisations bring. and the importance of those organisations being involved in the very start of planning processes and conversations around, you know, development of contracts and so on. We are working just now with COSLA and the Scottish Government on a programme called Strengthening Collaboration, and it's been running for about a year now, and we're currently looking at all the kind of obstacles that have stood in the way in terms of partnership working between the three sectors. But I think it's clear that it's a programme like that needs to be resourced effectively to be able to actually bring those different partners together and really look at practical areas where we can make a difference and improve how the different sectors work collaboratively. And obviously that's funded through the third sector resource budget line, which was cut in the budget by about £800,000 this year. So there's going to be restrictions on what you can do, whether it's going to impact on strength and collaboration, or it's going to impact on the volunteering action plan or the social enterprise action plan. But yeah, I think we do need to have a conversation about the health of the voluntary sector in Scotland and the role that government and Parliament can play in that. The UK government are, I think, doing something similar at the moment in terms of working with the Charity Commission around what they're planning to do to monitor the health of the charity sector and the wider voluntary sector. I'm not saying that in Scotland they should take a similar approach, but I do think it would be good to have a conversation about the role of voluntary organisations in Scottish society. We are not just a group of organisations, 45,000 organisations that turn up at a time of crisis. We are, I mean, I guess essentially we're always in a time of crisis somewhere, but we are there day to day delivering vital services. 100,000 employed staff, at least if you take kind of universities out of that equation and so on. So, a crucial part of the economy, larger staff base than the financial sector in Scotland. We need to look not just at the services that we deliver and how do we improve that, improve people's lives, but also how do we deliver fair work and good support for employees in the sector.
Thank you. I'll leave my questions there.
Thank you very much, Daniel. John, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, convener. We've covered a fair bit of ground already, but one of the questions asked the previous witnesses, which you might have seen, was, you know, just looking at the framework overall, is it at too high a level? Should there have been more detail? And maybe I can start with yourself, Mr. Melhuish.
It is very big handfuls. I think that is true. I think it's right. To go for multi-year, and maybe that dictates a bit of very high-level consultation at this start. But I think that would be a fair reflection to say, and certainly in our response, we buried through the government's own budget to try and see where things go in the future years, which does go into much more detail. But I think that would be a fair concern.
Okay, I mean I'll come on to the others on that same point later, but another witness who I previously quoted suggested that one way of giving more certainty over 5 years is to kind of hold back money at the beginning and therefore spend less and kind of build up a bit of reserve, and then would have more certainty for further down the line. Is that something you would support or what?
Certainly like the idea of a contingency reserve, but the difficulty is actually just finding, I suppose, the spare cash to be able to start creating one at this point. But the concept certainly, I think, is a good idea.
Okay, and the specific point for yourselves as well. I mean, it was mentioned already when you were answering Mr. Johnson about the idea that I think the UK government's been floating of some kind of tax on online retailers. I mean, is that something you're supporting, and is that something you think that would take pressure off our having to tax the shops on the street kind of thing?
So it only came out Friday, so I must admit we're still going to look at the detail. But I think the concept is that the online sales tax would help to lift the burden off retailers in particular, I believe, are the UK's proposals. Obviously, that would be very specific in England's case, but I think the support for retailers would then go back through the devolved administrations for some form of targeted support. But obviously that presumably would be within the remit of the Parliament once that process happens.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Bradley, if I can come on to you. I mean, the same general point, if you'd like to, do you think it's at too high a level?
I think, you know, the priorities in there they're good and they're worthy. I think that, you know, the final, the third priority around a fairer, stronger, greener economy, I mean, that heading alone, you could probably fit the whole voluntary sector in there and what it does. And so in that sense, yes, it is quite a high level. I do wonder about the absence of the national performance framework, and there's obviously a couple of links, you know, kind of a throwaway paragraph around linking to SDGs and the NPF, but how are we using the national performance framework to decide our spending priorities over the next few years? And I heard in the previous session kind of the assumption that we're using indicators from the NPF, and that's underpinning all of the stuff that's in the framework, but there's no explanation of that. And I think, again, it's a sign that we have a framework that we call the National Performance Framework, but yet we're not really necessarily using it to drive our performance. And so every time I guess a personal reflection is whenever I look at a new document, looking at whether it's, you know, the advisory group on economic recovery or this, there's always a different framework. There's a wellbeing framework, or there's a national performance framework, or there's, you know, three pillars, or there's these three priorities. And it's, I think it mentioned in the previous session, there seems to be a bit of a disconnect between all of this, and it's uncertain, I guess, for organisations, because they're trying to work out where they fit into this. Do they contribute to child poverty priority? Well, yes, they do, because they're employers, not even just thinking about the direct services that organisations provide. But I think beyond these priorities, we must see across all of government a shift to multi-year funding.
OK, I'll maybe come back to that point in a minute. I mean, I was interested, again, in Daniel Johnson's line of questioning about, you know, what people think of the voluntary sector, because it does cover an incredibly wide range of things. And I mean, at one end, you have got the, what I would call, you know, the small charities. Genuinely, they are all volunteers, they're getting no public money, and you're representing them. But you've also got big organisations, couriers, whatever, who are getting a lot of public money. I mean, do you think, as a sector, or some of these organisations have become too dependent on public money? Because they started off relying, presumably, on donations mainly.
Yeah. I think the organisations have been asked to, well, organisations since the financial crash have been trying to diversify their income. But the challenge with that is that also you then end up with an organisation that's potentially managing, one organisation I spoke to recently is managing about 36 different funding streams. So then you've got 30 different funding streams, 36 different funders, different reporting processes and everything, and then you're bogged down in all of that. So I think we do need to look at how the voluntary sector is funded overall and supported to make sure that it's fair for organisations, the small and medium-sized organisations too. But I think that the funding from government, other funding sources are very reluctant, not all of them, but other funders beyond government are very reluctant to provide core funding. They want to fund projects or specific activities. And to deliver a service or an activity or a project, you need an organisation. And where do you get the funding from to pay for all of those different things that that organisation needs to do to stay afloat, but also all the different things that the organisation needs to do to decarbonise, to deliver on Scotland's Fair Work ambition and all the other government ambitions that we want to contribute to, because we're a key sector.
OK, and I mean, the multi-year funding, which we did raise in the previous session as well, I mean, it works all the way through. You've got government, UK government gives it, Scottish government, local government, and often local government to voluntary organisations. I mean, would a compromise be that, you know, if, say, Glasgow City Council couldn't guarantee a particular charity, you know, 100% funding for the next 5 years, at least they could kind of guarantee the 80%, say, and that would give some certainty, and then they would have to say, well, we're going to have to flex the remaining bit depending on what we get.
Yeah, I think voluntary organisations are... We're pragmatic. We understand the challenges that governments face, and we understand the challenges that local government face and Scottish government. And I guess what we want to be able to do as organisations is to be able to plan effectively and have that financial certainty that I think COSLA were talking about. We need that in the voluntary sector. We need that to be able to retain staff, to to develop services, to put funding into services so we can develop them for the long term. You know, actually, even just supporting people in difficult points in their lives takes longer normally than an annual funding cycle. And if we're just focusing on that, then we're not going to be able to deliver on what we want to do. So I think in terms of the specific example, there could be a range of different options, I guess. But I think voluntary organisations are definitely pragmatic and understanding of the challenges, and that indicative funding, you know, knowing that, yes, things are unpredictable, but for a voluntary organisation, the risk that's transferred from government to voluntary organisations is substantial compared to the risk that a Scottish government would have in terms of the funding that's coming to them. Voluntary organisations simply don't know if they're going to get any funding. And that's a big difference between local government, national government and voluntary organisations.
Yes, because they would know if they're not exactly what they're going to get, but they're going to get a chunk.
Yes.
Whereas your members might end up getting nothing in April kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yep. Right. Okay, thanks. And finally, universities, Mr Sim, I don't know if you wanted to comment on my general kind of questions. Is the framework too high? Should the Scottish Government be trying to hold back reserves?
Yeah, I will. I'm not necessarily sure I'm concerned that the framework is too high. I think it's more that it's maybe too exclusive and that there are really important contributions that aren't necessarily embraced in the three priorities. I think, you know, for instance, individual growth and opportunity and what higher education can do to actually help you know, as an individual realise your talent and opportunities, that's not really reflected. Intergenerational impacts, I mean, there's obviously, you know, rightly an emphasis on child poverty, but how do we actually address intergenerational impacts, you know, with interventions, for instance, getting more adults into higher education and indeed, you know, completing the uncompleted national mission of driving forward widening access to higher education for people from socioeconomically disadvantaged backgrounds. And also international. I mean, I don't, you know, again, I think we should be ambitious for Scotland as an international actor. I mean, you know, from my perspective, obviously, we should be ambitious for higher education as one of Scotland's economic and reputational beacons. So, yeah, not so much concerns that it's high level, more concerns that the well-intentioned priorities are perhaps exclude other things that are really, really important to individuals' growth and to Scotland's well-being and growth. On the reserves point, I mean, I think the point you make is actually really interesting because actually it is exactly what universities have to do. You know, any surplus that they as charities generate gets held over as a reserve because that's largely where you have to find that margin for at least being able to do some investment in facilities and also the resilience against shock in an unpredictable world. I think the public finances, you know, work a bit differently with limited capacity to carry things over, but I think what you point to is really interesting because it's an example of how universities have to manage their business. I think the recommendation from funders is that you should at least maintain about a 2-3% surplus each year as a reserve, so you've got that investment margin and so you've got that resilience, and that's been extremely hard to achieve for a lot of institutions over recent years.
Well, I'm interested in you touching that because that actually was my next point and probably my final point. Because I took the chance, having been at Glasgow University, to look at their accounts, and their reserves at last July, unrestricted reserves, were £766 million and total reserves over £1 billion. Now, that is more than the Scottish Government is allowed to have in reserves, let alone actually have. And I just wonder, you know, and that's more than their total annual income. So when Glasgow University, and I accept it may be one of the richer ones, is sitting on so much money, you know, how can you plead that we're not paying enough for a student?
There are a number of things. I mean, there's a massive spread between different institutions on how much actually they're able to carry over. And I think in the last accounts that we saw, not the ones from 2021 to 22, but 2020, because they're not all complete yet, but 2021, I think about half of the institutions were actually in deficit. They weren't able to carry over anything from one year to another at all. Now, if you some institutions, as you say, have done better than that. you know, I don't know the details of Glasgow finances, but I do also know that, you know, they have also taken on, you know, massive amounts of borrowing to fund a really ambitious expansion in the West End that, you know, hugely increases their impact for good on their community in Glasgow and likewise across the Clyde in Govan. So, you know, I think there may be a balance there between, you know, what the money they actually need to have in the bank to demonstrate that they're an investable proposition so they can actually do these things that then get out and generate community benefit and generate economic benefit and research and innovation strength. So, you know, you're right to point to the issue, but I think there are, you know, if you're managing the university as a very, very big charitable institution, you do want to make sure you've got a margin there for investment, you've got a margin for resilience, you've got enough in the bank that you're actually an investable proposition when you want to go out and potentially borrow money to go out there and do something that's going to generate good for society and the economy.
I mean, I accept a lot of that. I totally accept the universities are doing good. I'm very proud of the fact we have some of the best universities in the world. I just think that when the Scottish Government is so tight for money for the next 5 years, that, you know, really we maybe need to see a little bit more of a financial contribution from the universities, because I don't think the colleges hold these reserves. I don't think the NHS holds these reserves. I don't think local government holds these reserves. I mean, the actual, just not to spend all my time at Glasgow University, but, I mean, the creditors' figure is £252 million. So that's a fine figure, and presumably that's what's been used for investment. But, I mean, the cash and cash equivalents is £488 million, and the investments are £247 million. So there appears to be a lot of extra money sitting there. And I just think, surely, would you not accept that if the Scottish Government is tight for money, we need to concentrate on the colleges, and we need to concentrate on the NHS and the local government, and the universities really have to tighten up a little bit.
I think there's a lot of priorities the government's got to balance. I mean, I've said I recognise that, but I do think, you know, two final things. That one is, as a charitable institution, you know, having a reasonable reserve is actually just what you should be doing as prudent management. And secondly, I think that there is actually pretty different across different parts of the sector and different institutions. You know, I think there are some, particularly the ones that have got that international capacity to go out and leverage in the international resource, that are typically in a slightly more robust condition than perhaps some of the more modern universities that don't have that sort of reputational standing internationally, have to work harder to generate that additional income. So it's certainly not I think Audit Scotland looked at this twice in the past 5 years, and their overall conclusion was that when you looked at the sector as a whole, the position of particularly University of Edinburgh and University of Glasgow as a really, really big institutions and really huge competitors in that international environment, that masked a stress that was widespread throughout the sector.
So maybe we should target our support more at the other universities?
I think there are fairness arguments that actually, you know, a student should be funded at a level that reflects the cost of teaching a student. I think that's a fairness argument that applies.
But your argument, surely we should pay more for a student maybe at, say, Caledonia than we do at Glasgow?
You know, I celebrate the fact that the University of Edinburgh, University of Glasgow have got something in there to invest. But, you know, they are also looking hard at, well, how do we actually do the best for students within the resources that we get. I mean, you know, having a decent reserve as a charity is where you should be, but it doesn't necessarily exempt you from having to make the hard examination of have you actually got what you need to support your borrowing, to invest in your facilities, many of which, as I've said, you know, even at the great universities, there's a major backlog of investment needed in facilities. Have you got what you need to actually have the staff-student ratio to do the best for your students? I mean, no one's exempt from having to make these hard decisions. And I think, you know, as a matter of fairness, Scottish Government should be funding the teaching and support of students at a level that properly reflects its cost, not least, as coming back to the beginning of this conversation, because that huge reliance on international students, you know, while it's great educationally, it's great culturally, it's a massive geopolitical risk.
Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, thank you very much, John. Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to dig a bit deeper into the, you know, the teaching grant of 7,400 that you mentioned. I guess that the Scottish Government would pay that for all Scottish students and would have been paying it for all EU students in the past, and that will sort of reduce over time. So the EU contribution side of it, is that a significant chunk of the overall teaching grant that comes in?
I can give you this EU student numbers, if you give me a second, but I couldn't actually give you the exact proportion of the teaching grant that was allocated to students. At the margins, what we're seeing is a cohort by cohort reduction in the number of EU students funded mm-hmm. from the SSE teaching grant. So that is helpful. You know, it's unhelpful in the sense that we actually really liked having the European students. Mm-hmm. A lot of courses, and I think particularly at Aberdeen. Benefited from having a really strong cohort of European students there. They brought real skills. But yes, it does create a little bit of cohort by cohort mm-hmm. flex in the system. I mean, we have seen a 50% crash in the number of EU students coming mm-hmm. Since fees were introduced for EU students, but we still hope to welcome those.
It's just thinking back to the original question that the convener asked, where the extra money would come from. Mm. I guess there is quite a significant saving to the Scottish Government on not having to pay those fees. And I guess what they could do instead would be to increase the rate per student to make up some of that without actually having to cost them any more, because they're actually paying less because they don't have to pay for the EU students.
I think that gives them a tiny bit of flex. I think when you look at the aggregate level of reduction in unit resource, and also the fact that other things have had to be absorbed, this year over £7 million of new graduate apprenticeships are being absorbed mm-hmm. into that core teaching grant. It means that the margin of discretion is quite low. But if I were to sort of express a shred of optimism, I would hope that the Funding Council, given what you've said about the EU students, might be able to put a little bit extra into the funding of each student this year. I don't think they would have the capacity to do anything that matched inflation or anything like that, but I think they may have a margin that enables them to at least make some sort of cash advance in the amount that students are funded at per. For universities.
Yeah, I guess there is a little bit of flexibility in there that has reduced. Thank you for that. David, I want to talk to you about one of my favourite topics in this committee is non-domestic rates. Like yourself from your submission, I find it hard to believe that in just 4 years, NDR is going to go up by 25%. Obviously, we've got new tone date in just a month's time, revaluation a year after that. So, for it to rise by that amount, I guess there's only a few options. The NDR base would have to increase significantly. Revaluation, I guess, would have to increase significantly. Or the poundage rate would have to increase significantly. So do you or any of your members see... Where's it going to come from?
I think we're very concerned about the upwards pressures on the poundage rate, given that we have the reservations expressed earlier about the growth of the rateable value tax base. And that's a major concern, because you then get into talk of competitiveness across the UK and so on. There's obviously higher rates for larger businesses right at the top, which are already beyond other parts of the UK. I think the overall shape of the tax base is one of great concern. It's effectively relatively few shoulders, because obviously the government's policy is to have a lot of rate relief at the lower rateable value thresholds or even exclude it. And that means that for a growing tax base, I think that's more pressure on fewer shoulders. We're very worried about it, because we don't see that growth is the answer, even though we've been very supportive of a lot of government initiatives, business growth accelerator and so on. Not always perfect, but I think the intent there has been excellent to try and support growth in the economy. We struggle to see where it goes, and obviously in the Northeast, the last revaluation came in at sort of just as the economy changed remarkably, and actually that led to government support being having to reduce very quickly too, in a way, although arguably maybe not as far as everyone had hoped from the industry side of things. But I would see a marked change coming up in the forthcoming revaluation, I would have thought, for northeast offices and so forth.
I think there's a lot of businesses in the northeast that are pinning their hopes on the revaluation, and obviously being delayed for a couple of years has been quite frustrating, I would say. Another area that you sort of point out in your submission is the empty rates relief.
Yes.
In the northeast, you know, I see plenty of good commercial property being bulldozed to save on NDR. Do you think that devolving that to local authorities is going to make things better or worse?
Well, we've been talking to local authorities, and it has to be said that I think this policy transfer is something that they're only just beginning to get their heads around. Mm-hmm. And I believe there are discussions with the government about financial transfer as well to support the cost of relief, which is much lower now than it once was. But I think the problem with the way the system works in particular at the moment is, rates... The rates that property companies, landlords, developers will pay for properties that have fallen vacant, largely because they have no market anymore, are just part of the cost. So you have insurance, you have facilities, you have all sorts of costs. So the rates is really an additional tax on failure, if you like, because quite often they do not have a lineup of tenants coming in. And it actually skews the market, which may well come through in the revaluation, because a sitting tenant will be able to say, well, if you don't basically accept a rental offer of next to nothing, sometimes it is nothing, just so that the tenant takes the rates, then guess what, we're off elsewhere, and you know, we'll leave you with that large tax burden with no income to pay it. So it's a... we've often heard in this chamber in particular on this policy in there that, you know, this is an incentive for landlords to let property. Landlords like to let properties because they like rental income, and we just make that point straightforwardly. And so I think the system now, in areas where you do have fundamentally weak markets, I'm afraid, is the case that, the landlords are really over a barrel in many ways, and having to take very, very little in the way of rental payments, which should come through in what the assessors start to find, actually. And, I mean, that is another reason to question the estimations of the growth in NDR over the next few years.
And I guess also in terms of speculative development, I guess it would just be too high a risk there for people to come in and build without knowing that they've got a guaranteed rental at the end of it.
Well, I mean, developers is not... is a lot more complex and a heck of a project, and a lot of risk as part and parcel of that project. So, you know, developers will have the cost, for reasons explained earlier, of holding properties whilst they're trying to revitalise them, bring them back into use. You obviously have processes that have to be met and gone through in regulatory terms there, planning and so on. So the BGA was there to help speculative development, but at the moment the financing for speculative development, we're in a very risk-averse world, and really we have been since the financial crash, and arguably had only just begun to see the flickers of recovery in many ways, even in certain aspects of the central belt, I would argue. So I think that is a deep concern, and I think the thinking around empty rates policy, which is transferring, as you say, in a year's time, and will affect a huge number of public ratepayers as well with vacant properties, is something that we do feel needs to be rethought. And I think, all we really ask for from our members is a chance to do something to get some of these properties back into effective use, which may well be a change of use.
Yeah, from my point of view, I think a lot of local authorities are going to have people queuing up at their door, expecting local authorities to be able to do something around rate relief, because we see the same thing about the local rate relief schemes that they've got the power to do, but they don't have any money to do. And I guess, you know, we've heard earlier about the squeeze on local government resources. And I just would be concerned that your members are going to be queuing at the door of these local authorities and they've got no money to offer any schemes at all.
Yes, and our members, they don't want to be in that way. They want to be producing new properties to support the tax base. But, you know, at the same time, with the pressures that they have themselves, it's hard for them to try and regenerate our towns and city centres if they're having to, you know, fork out a lot of tax in rates where they don't have the income coming to cover it.
So I guess the key thing would be, if we really want city centre regeneration, there needs to be proper schemes in place at a national level, because local government can't really afford it.
I believe the discussions are going to take place between the government as they transfer the into REITs policy, but we don't know where that will lead to yet.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Kim.
Okay, thank you, Michelle.
Hi, just to finish off quickly, can I ask you, Alistair, because I'm not sure of this figure myself, you've quoted per head for students, but what percentage of funding does the university sector get, the overall percentage from the Scottish Government?
Varies hugely by institution. If you're looking at somewhere
like aggregated, like over.
I think it's about 35%. I thought I had it in here, but it is very, very variable between institutions. As I say, if you're at UHR, UWS, you're about 60-70% from Scottish Government. If you're at St Andrews, it's more like 15%.
And do you know what the aggregated percentage is for the rest of the UK? I'm just interested in...
It's radically different in England and Wales because of their fee structure. I mean, basically, even though the money they get per student is £9,250, it's kind of coming to them through the Student Loans Company. That's not counting as government expenditure. So they're in accounting terms, they're... dependence on government funding would be much lower, and obviously in actual terms, you know, they're basically able to cover their costs on teaching home students in a way that we can't, because we're getting sort of less than 90% of cost of teaching home students.
Okay, I suppose that leads me on to my main question. We in this committee, when we agree and inquire, we're helped very ably by the clerks in devising what is asked in terms of calls for evidence. And one of the questions, it says, does the framework properly reflect the current economic and political context? And I was a bit surprised in terms of the SECO and also yourselves that you didn't reflect on the political context, because what you highlight there is clearly a political context where the rest of the UK has gone down a fee route and levying all those that kind of the loans on students, and the Scottish Government has elected not to do that. And I was just checking earlier, and I don't know if my figure is correct, it's probably a few years out of date, but for example, in Holland, 61% of funding to universities aggregated comes from central government, and that's clearly starkly different. So I suppose to yourself, Alistair, I was quite surprised not to see a reflection of the political context when we connect it also with your comments about attracting a working age population outside our borders. Obviously we know, and it's come out this morning, that Scotland's been greatly affected by Brexit. And also yourself, Paul, you mentioned about SNP, and that I agree with your figures about 2 billion capex is low. I personally would like to see it much higher. So I suppose my question to all three of you is, what makes you avoid this kind of political contextualisation? And before you answer, I'm well aware that we are living in, you know, we're living in quite polarised times in Scotland. I understand that. And I say that not from one side of the fence. I'm merely recognising that as a fact. And what, as a relatively new member, what I'm seeing with this committee and the Economy Committee is that people are reluctant to tell it how it is, for fear of getting into what is quite a polarised debate at the moment. But from my context, sitting in this committee where we actually were interested in the numbers and the financial transactions, that reluctance is inhibiting understanding. And I think we saw that earlier looking at talking about COSLA and SIPFA, I think it was. So my question then is, in the light of your comments this morning, if you were going to recomplete the does the framework properly reflect the current economic and political context, is there anything you would like to add that's not in your submission? now you're on
it. Let me not be uninhibited then. I think two things. I mean, one, you know, I think I've alluded to this already, is actually surely the political and economic context for Scotland has got to be ambition for growth, you know, inclusive growth, green growth, but ambition for growth, and, you know, because it's a good thing in itself, because it provides opportunities for people, and then because it creates this virtuous cycle of actually generating tax revenue that supports the decent public services that we all want. And that's what I felt was not front and centre in the spending review consultation in the way that I felt it should be. Also, just, you know, you asked the contrast and policy position between Scotland and England on how we fund students. Now, you know, there is a really broad cross-party consensus in Scotland now that publicly funding students is the right thing to do, but I think we would respond to that and say that actually puts an increased onus on Scottish Government to step up to the mark and actually fund them properly. In England, you know, the government has slightly sort of stepped away from that responsibility, but I think in Scotland, you know, given the strong political consensus that students should be publicly funded, you know, I think there's a strong argument they should be properly publicly funded at a level that reflects the costs of teaching them and providing them the services they deserve. And, you know, that has been substantially eroded since the policy decision was made, you know, when last time Scottish Government examined this way back in 2010-11, to really, you know, plonk firmly for that policy and plonk and to choose that policy, you know, in a really permanent way. Since that policy was chosen, particularly since 2014-15, we've seen the policy, which is widely supported, maintained, but the funding of it eroded.
See, I knew you would enjoy it. Thank you for that. So to the other two panellists then, just to finish up, is there anything you would like to add to that question, perhaps that's triggered some thoughts coming out of today? Paul, I can see you're taking a deep breath.
No, there isn't. There really isn't. I think our submission, you know, we aren't worried, or I don't think we do hold back as an organisation in terms of highlighting the issues that we think are there. And I know that many charities do feel that way, do feel like they have to hold back because of their funding arrangements. And I, in my 5 years at SCBO, I have not felt like that. And I would want that to come across in our responses. I think to this committee back in pre-budget scrutiny, we were clear about the need for Scottish Government, UK Government to look at how it, you know, managed to navigate the whole multi-year funding issues and working together. Of course, we're careful in terms of treading into kind of difficult areas that we shouldn't be treading into as a voluntary organisation, as a registered charity. But our submission this time is purely about what is the Scottish Government going to do. And they have the power now to deliver a multi-year spending review. And that's what we wanted to focus on. And we didn't want to focus on... We've been focusing on things around UK government and other places in other submissions, but in this case, we've been focusing solely on the Scottish Government's allocation of funding to voluntary organisations and to local government, and hopefully from local government to voluntary organisations.
And last, David?
A huge question. I guess as an interest group, we tend to focus on policies rather than politics because politics can change very quickly. And, you know, we're keen to work with whoever the government or opposition of the day are in that broadest sense. It's you can't avoid, I think earlier we alluded to the fact that we thought there ought to be some more enhanced borrowing powers for this parliament. I mean, the differential between the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government can borrow, and you compare that with Public Works Loans Board and individual councils, and we've seen some of the great things that Dundee have done and led in with making use of some of those enhanced borrowing powers. You know, seems to us to be a clear demarcator that you know, a better agreement could be found somewhere along the lines. But you're probably right. We do usually not enter into too much of a political diktat, but it's but we do think there are some improvements that could be made between those kind of balances.
Well, thank you very much for that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think that appears to have exhausted all the questions that we have as a committee. I just want to thank our witnesses for their excellent evidence giving today, and I'm going to call a 2-minute break in order for us to get into private session just for a few moments. So thank you very much.